and gentlemen, and welcome to Legends. My name is Paul Brennan, and I'm going to be your MC for this evening. Before we go any further, I'd just like to point out a few things. First of all, could I ask everybody to look, take their mobile phones from their pockets, have a look, and make sure it's either switched off or on silent. We don't want any phones ringing. That's great. The next thing I'd ask is that, because there's over 800 people in the room, the least bit of chatter will be picked up. Now, it's going to be very difficult for people to hear if people are talking, so I hope everyone appreciates that, you know, to be silent throughout the interviews. I'd also like to point out that in the event of a fire, the fire exits are on either side here, and we also have four fire exits at the back of the room. I would also appreciate if everyone could remain seated throughout the performance, and please refrain from getting refreshments from the bar below. There will be an interval. You should also note that the balcony is off limits for smoking. If you want to have a fag, go down the front, okay? I would also ask you, this is the last rule now, I swear, I would also ask you at the interval, if you have a drink, if you could please just bring your glasses down to the bar with you, okay? Because it's dangerous with so many people, glasses and bottles. So if you could please do that, I'd much appreciate it. Anyway, off we go. Firstly, I'd like to say, I hope you'll see that at the interval, and you saw it before, that we have a raffle, okay? We're hoping this is our last bastion to make money. First prize is a 55-inch Samsung LED curved TV with all the bells and whistles worth $2,300. That was donated by Mark's next door neighbour, David Walsh from Netwatch. So we thank David for that. It's a huge prize. I'll just list out some of the prizes that we have, okay? First prize is a 50-inch Samsung curved LED 3D smart TV. Second prize is a Kelly's Harbour Rosslare voucher, two-night break with champagne. Third prize, a weekend to the Metropole Hotel in Cork. Fourth prize, a €100 voucher for the Arboretum and a €100 voucher for the Lord Bagnall. Fifth prize, an autographed picture of Aidan O'Brien's horse Camelot in winning the Investec Derby, signed by Aidan and Joseph O'Brien. Sixth prize, a Sean Kelly framed racing top. €100 voucher for Max Menswear in Tullow Street. Seventh prize, a Carton House round of golf, a four ball, and also four rounds of golf in Carlow Golf Club, and a signed hat by Pádraig Carrington. And we also have loads for our final prize, and it's by no means our eighth prize, because we have loads of merchandise from the IRFU, bags and jerseys, Leinster jerseys, Ireland jerseys, everything like that. So fantastic prizes. So please, please, please support our raffle, okay? I would also like to thank all of the businesses who sponsored this event. I know that Mark has been overwhelmed by the sheer amount of sponsorship that has come in over the past few months, and for that I know he would like to thank you all. Now, I know that most of the audience know Mark, but for those of you who don't, Mark is 53 years of age and is married to Kate. They have four children, Ella, Simon, Stephen and Luke. Last February, Mark was diagnosed with motor neuron disease, and since then it has had a devastating effect on the lives of his family. Okay, later on, Mary Reeve from the Irish Motor Neuron Disease Association will come up and speak more about motor neuron and how their organisation helps and supports people who've been diagnosed with the disease. All of the proceeds from tonight's fundraiser will go directly to the Irish Motor Neuron Disease Association. There's no, our costs are run at a minimum, and you know, we hope to head, we're heading for 50,000 at the moment, so hopefully we'll break that target, and it all depends on the raffle tonight, so please do support again. Since his diagnosis, Mark has been very appreciative of all the help and support that he has been given to him by the Irish Motor Neuron Disease Association, and he felt that he would like to repay them by doing a fundraiser to help their cause. As a result, he approached some of the clubs that he's been part of down through the years. Sorry, bear with me a second. Yeah, as a result, he has he came to the clubs that he's been part of down through the years, okay? And without question, all of the clubs helped him out. In my day job in the voluntary sector, I'm secretary of Collection GA, and Mark would have been a committee member. So that's how I would have met Mark, you know? And just for the record, Mark is a man that, and his family, they're people that I highly, highly respect. You know, Mark is a doer. And, you know, I don't know what to say about it. People are going to pay him more compliments tonight, you know, and I'm going to leave it at that. But I think it's important to acknowledge the club's contribution to this fundraiser. So if you don't mind, just bear with me for 1 second. I'd just like to thank, name check the committee, because they've put in a lot of hard work over the past few months. So we'll start off with the clubs. The first club involved is Collection GAA. And I'd like to thank those, and especially Breda MacDonald, Eddie Brennan, Lawrence Phelan, and Rebecca McDermott, who done this lovely set design that we have here tonight. With Carlow Rugby Club, I'd especially like to thank Stuart Bailey, Patrick Brennan, Andy Dooley, and Rachel O'Brien. Also, from Carlow Tennis Club, I'd like to thank Jim Nolan. And from Carlow Institute of Technology, I would like to thank Pauline Madigan. I can't let this opportunity also pass without thanking Colin and his staff in the Woodford Dolmen, who have been absolutely fantastic over the past few months. Anything that we wanted was no hassle, and they've done a fabulous job. And I have to say, the Woodford Dolmen, they're after investing 500,000 so far and another million to go, and I'm sure anyone that's come in has noticed the change, that the place is looking absolutely fantastic. So a round of applause for Colin and his staff. I'm not going to rattle on all night, so we're nearly at the end. Finally, I hope that everyone enjoys the night. And remember, it's not a sad night. Tonight is a night we will celebrate one of Mark's greatest passions, which is sport. And on that, I would like to welcome Mark's daughter, Ella, to the stage to say a few words. Where are you, Ella?
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to our IMNDA fundraiser, Legends with Miriam. On behalf of my family, myself, my parents Mark and Kate, and my three brothers, Simon, Stephen and Luke, I would like to welcome you here tonight to the Woodford Dolmen Hotel and thank everyone for their donations and generosity for this very worthy cause. We continue to be astounded and heartened by the ongoing support we have received from family members, friends and our local community, both in Carlow and Collection, since my dad's diagnosis earlier this year. Since February, the Irish Motor Neuron Disease Association have played a large part in my family's life and has been there with the advice and assistance that we needed after receiving the devastating news. A large part of the association's funds go towards medical equipment and aids for people with MND, along with ongoing contributions towards MND research. I would also like to thank our committee members, headed up by the brilliant Paul Brennan. Without the help of the committee, we would not all be seated here tonight. A special mention to all our guests tonight also, especially the host, the wonderful Miriam O Callaghan, who also easily agreed to come down to Carlow tonight and help with our fundraising efforts. I'm now going to read some words on behalf of my dad, who unfortunately cannot get up here tonight and do so himself. Good evening and thank you for your tremendous generosity. I'm truly humbled by the amount of goodwill that is out there. We would not be here this evening without the inspirational leadership of Paul and so many marvellous friends helping me to organise this amazing event. I am, as most of you know, a fanatical sports fan and reared in the great games of rugby and Gaelic football. You get so much more out of these games than just performing on the pitch, and the comradeship off the pitch makes for so much more on your personal happiness and well-being. I sometimes describe getting motor neuron disease as quite bizarre. To this day, I truly have not a clue where it came from. Last year, I could not have been fitter, having just completed the cycle from Carlow to Achill Island in one day. My family still maintain that when I left our house that morning, I was only supposed to cycle to the local shop to get the newspaper. When down in Achill celebrating my sister Mary's birthday, I noticed after a couple of pints, I was slurring a few words. Eventually, I received confirmation of diagnosis in Beaumont Hospital from Professor Orla Hardiman in February of this year. It was a shell shock to the system and still is. I'm not going to go into all of my symptoms, but it's been a roller coaster both physically and emotionally. My voice is practically gone at this stage, and I now have to use an iPad or an iPhone a lot of the time to communicate. I've never been one for staying quiet at Gaelic matches, and a lot of people have pointed out to me that they knew there was a problem with my voice when they couldn't hear me on the sideline shouting. Also, my swallowing has meant my diet has completely changed, and I can no longer enjoy a Sunday roast. I enjoy my food, but I've had to make major adjustments, and I'm fast approaching a time where I may need to have direct food intake. You also get extremely emotional with MND, something my family chastened to add I already was. With my presentation of bulbar MND, you get excessive bouts of yawning and general fatigue, and I'm beginning to lose some dexterity in my left hand. But I have a tremendous amount to be thankful for. I have a tremendous support from my wonderful wife, Kate, and family. I still have great strength in my legs and can still just about manage a round of golf. It is so wonderful to avail of the simple pleasures in life, like going for a walk. Also, I can tip around in my racer, but Mount Leinster is off the map. As Albert Einstein once said, life is like riding a bicycle. To keep your balance, you must keep moving. I picked up some good words of advice about a person's basic needs and routes to happiness, and I'd like to share these with you. They are as follows. One needs to feel part of a local community, and one needs to give and receive from family, neighbours and friends. I think the above advice is very apt in my case and will provide strength when times get tough, and obviously they will lighten my load with MND. I would personally like to thank Miriam O Callaghan and our guests for their participation in Legends with Miriam. I do hope you enjoy the great night's entertainment lined up, and it is a fitting tribute to a fabulous group of friends that we are here tonight. And finally, a parting truth about all our lives. Life is all about living for the joy of today and the promise of tomorrow. And as Nelson Mandela once said, the greatest glory in life lies not in never falling, but in rising every time we fall. Thanking you, one and all, for your tremendous support.
Very well done, Ella. I would now like to introduce our next speaker, who is Mari Reavy from the Irish Motor Neuron Disease Association. Welcome up here, Mari, okay?
Thanks very much, Paul. Good evening and welcome, everyone. And totally overwhelmed by the support, but not one bit surprised. I came down here probably about 8 weeks ago to meet Mark Attride and his family, and Paul and all the committee. And to say they are doers is unbelievable. I've never seen anything like it. Just look at the room, it's unbelievable. It's a real fitting tribute to you, Mark, and what people think of you. I'm not going to be any doom and gloom, but I just want to give you a bit of an insight of what motor neuron is. Basically, it's a terminal illness. There is no cure. People have 3 to 5 life expectancy, but we have a man that's lived for 40 years, so there is hope. At any one time, there's about 310 people in Ireland that have motor neuron, and there's one person diagnosed every 5 days, but sadly, one person passes away, so it's a bit like a revolving door. It's like you're an ordinary person doing ordinary day things, going about your daily life, and suddenly this happens, so it doesn't discriminate against anybody. Mark was a very active person in every way, brilliant athlete, brilliant lecturer, and this comes to his door. And until it comes to your door, sadly people don't realise the impact it has and the devastating impact it has on the person and the family and friends around. Colin Murray, I suppose, for us brought it into the limelight. He was a great ambassador. I'm sure people saw his documentary, and he called it the pits, progressive, incurable, terminal and shite. So we're an association that we're 29 years, we're celebrating our 30 years next year, and we've grown a lot. We provide services, and sadly we can't provide a cure at the moment. Professor Ola Hardiman in Beaumont works tirelessly with her team, and she's working hopefully to find a cure, and someday hopefully I'll be able to stand up and say there is a cure or there's something you can take to kind of level this out. So what we provide in the association is services like our nurse specialist. One of our nurses is here tonight, and the other girl, she's Etna and Fidama. They travel around the country and they visit people in their homes, because sadly some people with motor neuron can't go outside the homes. And our ethos is that people stay at home for as long as possible and live with the comfort of their own homes with dignity. A big thing now for us is communication. And as you can see, sadly, Mark, his voice is deteriorating. So we provide things like iPads or iPhones. And there's a thing called an eye gaze, and people would use that to communicate. And it's literally you communicate through your eyes, and you type something into an iPad and it speaks out. And there's a lovely lady down in Cork, and she was using that for about 3 years. And she has two small children, and her husband says it's great. She still gives out even though she can't talk. So, you know, there's a bit of humour. And, you know, I think humour and love is really important, and that's obviously really, really here tonight. So, like, simple things like you get up this morning, you had a shower, you washed your teeth, you dressed yourself. People with motor neuron can't really do that. You know, we provide services. We're a very small organisation. We need about probably $1 million a year to let us provide services of home help, counselling, equipment. But one of the major things that happened to us in this year was the Ice Bucket Challenge, and thanks everybody that did it. Mark was nominated by Miriam. It was brilliant. It totally took us by surprise. It came from a young man called Peter Freights in the USA. He's from Boston. He was a baseball player. And him and his friend were talking one day, and they said, what can we do now to raise awareness or raise money? And they said, oh, let's put ice in a bucket. And that was quite simple. But the whole thinking behind it was, when you lift that bucket over your head and put the ice, and suddenly, if anyone did it, you couldn't catch your breath for like a split second. And that's what it's like with motor neuron. And, you know, can you imagine that's a recurring incident? So for us, that was huge. And we, in the association, we got 1.6 million in donations, and the money's still coming in. So we're going to donate a huge amount of that money to research, which I think is really important, because obviously if there's research and we find out where it comes from, we'll be able to find how to manage it, how to cure it. One of our lovely ladies, she's one of our clients, she's only 42, and she said to us a while back, she did an advertising campaign for us on the radio, people might have heard her. She said, a year ago, I camped overnight to get to the front of the Gary Barlow concert. She was mad about Gary Barlow. Now I need an entourage as big as this to get to the gig. Someone to dress me, someone to do my hair, someone to do my makeup, and somebody to wheel my chair onto the platform. That's because I have motor neuron. So it explains it in a very simple way that, you know, there for the grace of God go any of us. So from the association, we just want to thank everybody here tonight for supporting Mark and his family. Thanks to Paul and all the fabulous committee. I feel very privileged to have met them, even under these circumstances. And I think you're going to have a great night. And I just want to show a little clip of a thank you from the IMDA for all your support. Enjoy your night.
So, who's up for the Ice Bucket Challenge? Yeah, that was so last week.
This week, it's about providing patient care.
It's about answering the phone to those who are newly diagnosed.
It's about different equipment right across the country.
It's about finding better treatments and ways of stopping the illness in its tracks.
It's about hope that one day a diagnosis of motor neuron disease won't be a life sentence.
You know, the Ice Bucket Challenge was a little bit annoying for some in the end. This week, it's about the money you donated and how it's best put to use. For all of those who drowned themselves in ice cold water, for all those who texted, on behalf of the 360 patients with motor neuron disease in Ireland, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well done, Mary, and all the good work they're doing in the IMNDA. Now, the main event. Let's kick it off, okay? So, without further ado, it gives me great pleasure to welcome your host for the night, Miriam O Callaghan. Colin, you wouldn't go see where she is, would you? Please. Sorry about this, sorry. Thanks. Sorry about this. Little hiccups. Miriam, the show's about to begin. Miriam.
Hi, Colin. I'll be with you in a second, genuinely. I'm just powdering my nose. Right, you. These won't clip themselves. Get on with it, will you? For God's sake. Oh, hurry up. Come on, we're going. That's enough. We're going, come on. Let's get out of here. Right, this is the last gig I'm ever doing for free. You are so... Can you just say more when we're on stage, for God's sake? Hi, Colin. I'll be with you in a second. Right, come on. Now, don't be a diva. I'm outstage, front. You're behind me, always behind me, right? Always behind me. You got that? God almighty, I hate working with amateurs. Oh, is this the door? Where's the door? The door, oh my God. Okay, just stay away from me when we're on stage, okay? When I ask you to do something. Okay, now we're over here. Okay, this is it, okay. Oh my God, I've forgotten something. Okay, my whiskey now! Okay.
Ladies and gentlemen, Miriam O Callaghan! She's a
to follow Mario, seriously, but I do love him. I love him very much. Anyway, just to say, I'm really delighted to be here tonight. It is a tribute to how popular Mark Attride and his family is that on a Wednesday night in the Dolman Hotel in Carlow, there are almost 1,000 people. So I'd like to applaud Mark and his family. And look, we're going to get into the main show. Let's not wait any longer. It's a live show. My first two guests are true legends in their lifetime. So let me introduce you straight away to a man who has been commentating on GAA matches for about 1,000 years. He's not just the most wonderful commentator in terms of the GAA. He's a magnificent Irish speaker. He's from Kerry. He knew my dad. And he's retired only a short time. And he's an encyclopedic memory of everything to do with the GAA. Give a really, really warm welcome to Micheal O Muircheartaigh. Yeah. And joining Micheal is another true legend. I said you'd an encyclopedic memory of GAA. I think this guy may even know more than me, all of it's possible, in terms of Olympics and World Cups. Jimmy McGee is coming.
I'm embarrassed with scores of others and doubtless with RD and
D. Thank you, Jimmy.
It was one giant step for mankind when man woke up. The props were the first of us all. And the next step.
There. I mean, people talk about legends and it's an abused and a misused term, but you both are. Remind people, Micheal, actually, how you got into doing what you do.
By false pretenses. Very simple. I was a student in St. Patrick's Training College in Drumcondra. and a little notice appeared that Radio Erin, as it was at the time, were holding auditions in Croke Park the following Sunday for a commentator, Oscar Aitken. Anybody interested, come along. Style 5, get in free. That was a tremendous attraction. Get into Croke Park free, and I was only maybe a month in Dublin, if even more. And then others, about 10 of us went along. Others came from other institutions. We were all, for all the world now, like this. A roof over us, we couldn't see the picture then. 5 minutes each, ever a hay and ever a doe. My turn came. I was shocked when I went out to the hurling game. And I had never seen a hurling game. I was from Kerry. Handed a little piece of paper with the names on it. And I recognised one name, and he was in goal for UCD, Ted Hurley. And the red light went on for me to start my 5 minutes. Even though the schlitter wasn't that side of the field, those adjudicating were down below, they could see nothing. At that very moment, Ted Hurley was bringing off the greatest save ever seen in Croke Park. Cleared it out, the ball was still on the other side of the field, cleared it out toward the cue stand. A foul and a deflection, it went over the line, it was a line ball. Who was called out to take it? The only one I knew, Ted Hurley. Took the line ball, a dreadful foul in the full forward. At this stage, the schlitter was on the other side of the field. At 21, he was called all the way up from the goal. So I was having great fun. It was an adventure. And while he was coming up, I was talking about his brother Bob, who was in the class in Dingle behind me. This Ted was a hurler because his parents were bankers. And they were moved around, letting the hurler into Brayley. So he was brought down to take the imaginary 21. Of course, he scored the goal. And on his way back, I spoke about his sisters. They just swim in the same beach as myself. So my 5 minutes extended to 15.
Wow.
And I was asked there and then, would I broadcast the Railway Cup final the following Sunday week, 10 days later. And again, being innocent and from Kerry, I said, why not? Shin Mara hosting me, and it was a great break to get. We speak about getting breaks in life, be they good or bad. These things happen, but it was a great break, and I've been enjoying myself at matches ever since.
And we've been enjoying you ever since.
Well, I don't know.
Jimmy, how did you get into it?
I was in it when I was born. Now, really, I always, we had an old radio at home. You had to charge the battery.
They were well off.
Young people,
they were well off. Yeah.
For young people here, at a time, there was no plugging in, no electricity, nothing like that. And you had to have a battery to run the radio. And they would be old car batteries, generally. And you had to go to a place to get them charged for the big game on a Sunday. My uncle John went out to Dundalk once with a wet battery, and he had it on his knee. And when he got up at the station in Dundalk, he stood up at there were strips of the thing coming up and burned the trousers off him, all the way down the front. And he got out in the station and the trousers fell down. And the trouble with poor old John, he was embarrassed. I don't know what he'd be embarrassed about, but he was embarrassed anyway. And he went to the station master, he gave him the long run overcoat. Now, I don't know if it made any lasting damage, but I know this much, he became a soprano overnight. Anyway, look. I did want to become a commentator. I really did. And I suppose Micheal O'Hare, who came before Micheal O Muircheartaigh, did the All-Ireland Final in New York in 1947. And we all assembled in this person's house to listen to this thing. I thought, I didn't give a damn whether it was Kevin or Kerry won. Different for you. But I made up my mind that there and then that I was going to do this one day. So immediately I wrote to Radio Erin as it was, and somebody told me to look for an audition. I had no idea what an audition was. It could have been a fruit, it could have been anything. But my mom, fair play to her, looked it up in a dictionary, which she had to borrow from the people across the road, whose uncle was a school teacher. And I found out what an audition meant, and I did send the letter. I was only 10 or something at the time. Wow. Naturally, I got a reply that said, don't call us, we'll call you. and on that went. And eventually, I kept on writing once a year. And one day, I got a call from a man called Harry Thuler.
I do have
a fantastic man, now deceased. And he said, you want looking for an audition? So I went up to a studio, a private studio, a very private studio, and had this audition, so-called. And that was on a Tuesday. And on the Thursday, I had a phone call, couldn't believe it. This is Harry Thuley here. That we were very impressed by for a young fella. That was very good. Would you do a game on Saturday for us?
Sure.
I'd love to, a hockey game. Pembroke Wanderers and Three Rock Rovers. Now, I come from Cooley County Louth, which is a head the ball place of Gaelic games, Gaelic football.
Great place for hockey.
Oh, gee, hockey. Three Rock Rovers and Pembroke Wanderers had fantastic fan clubs. I said, I'll do it. And that was in May 1956, and I'm still doing it.
Wow, Jimmy, wow. Well, it's probably an impossible question to answer for both of you, but in terms of the career that you have both had and spanned so many decades, are there standout moments for you, Micheal, of matches or players? I know we've so many great players coming even on tonight, it's invidious to choose somebody, but have there been the greatest players that you have seen and the greatest games that you've enjoyed?
The greatest occasions, and the most unusual, was actually the first game I ever did.
Okay.
Munster and Leinster in the Railway Cup final. And, you know, the legends of Leinster and Munster played. And the Railway Cup was very big that time, I think over 40,000 people. Terrific game that ended in a draw. But it's what happened over the next 3 days that's imprinted it in my memory forever. It was of a Thursday, St. Patrick's Day. Munster decided it's not worth going home. We're coming up again for Sunday. We'll stay. And I knew where they were meant to stay, but they never arrived. On the Sunday night, the Munster captain, his name was Bat Garvin, who was living out around Harris Cross, Kimmage. There was an all-night party there. Even the bedrooms had to be cleared to make way for extra dancing space. Dancing was a big craze that time. That was Thursday night. Friday was spent in the zoo. We were told there was a bar there. And still no sleep. Saturday, they were invited to the Guard, the club in Harrington Street. And it being a guard, the place was very late on Saturday night when everyone went up to Barry's Hotel, where they were meant to have been all along. Sunday morning then, I remember walking up. They walked up. And you knew Paddy Baum Brosnan. He was only gone 20 yards when he said he felt unsteady. Now, I wasn't broadcasting the replay. We brought him into the Belvedere Hotel and I told him that this man is unsteady in his playing in the match. Whatever they brought out in a bottle, he had the game of his life. And even though Leinster went to their homes on Thursday, had a training session Saturday, to this day it stands out as the biggest win that Munster ever had. So I'm firmly convinced that all this intensive training that the legends here tonight, there's no need of it all. Now, you might believe this is true. There's a man that played that day. His name is Mick Finucane. And this is 1949. He is still drawing children's allowances. He is.
Yes. Yes, unfortunately, his wife died, and after a respectable length of time passed by, he met and married another lady.
That is
considerably younger than him, but not exactly a child bride.
And
they had children.
That's okay.
And according to Mick, the great Mick Finucane, he reckons he's the only man ever who, when he goes to the post office on the first Tuesday of every month, collects the old age pension and the children's allowance. I want to be like that. I want to be one of those.
I presented an award for some types of athletics to his daughter quite recently in the secondary school in Ballybunion. Wow. She's now a student of acting, I think, down in UCC or something.
Fantastic.
The great Mick Finucane, and strangely, the day that the great Paddy O'Shea died, I had visited Mick. I was on my way back from Dingle, and I decided to call to see this Mick Finucane. I think it was his 94th birthday. And I was talking to him aside in the kitchen, and the phone rang. And I picked it up, and it was another guy that you'd know, Micheal O'Shea, who in a couple of our Ireland would carry us beyond ready on the bed. He just said a few words to us, and I knew what he meant. Tá ár rí imbe uí. Yeah. Our king has gone from us. There was no need to ask him who was the king. There were neighbours. Tá ár rí imbe uí. It was inside Mick Finucane's house I heard that. But that was a memorable game. Of course, there were several others. I could tell you how Jimmy's was.
Okay. Oh, God. Okay, let's play that game.
Do you know what it was?
What sort of trouble are you getting in?
Now, it was hockey. And I was... I was in the studio and Jimmy was doing a bit of a commentary, and somebody in the studio, and you must have said down to Jimmy along the line, you know, there's no atmosphere coming through. And Jimmy, being the quick thinker, he said, hold on a minute. There was actually nobody at the match. And Jimmy just put his head out the door and gave it two terrific roars, you know, shouting. That was atmosphere. And he continued.
That reminds me. All the stuff he's told you there is not all lies. Tom and Mick Finucane, did you see that at the end of the paper about 3 weeks ago? Where the man of 80-something married the 24-year-old girl.
Oh, yes, yes.
Well, is this on your mind, Jimmy, at the moment?
No, it's on your mind. I think you're a bit young for me. But I want to tell you this. Don't mind
me looking around for a suitable... Is it companion, you said? Yeah.
I put an ad in the Evening Herald. I should never have done it. I put in the picture, and I should never have done it. But this guy, this is a fact, you may have seen it. Why shouldn't he marry this young girl? And what's more, he was an optimist. And how do I know that?
Why?
Because he bought a new house beside the school.
For you, Jimmy, between the Olympics and the World Cup, I mean, did you watch John O'Shea's goal last night?
Fantastic. I loved it for lots of reasons. One, 100 caps. Two, last kick of the game.
Yeah.
Three, he was wearing the captain's armband at the time. And four, and most important, he's a lovely fella.
Yeah.
And it couldn't have happened to a nicer man.
That's so true.
So it was perfect. Yeah.
Interesting, actually, Jimmy, when you look at soccer now, like, I've some daughters here tonight, but we've young boys in our house, and because the Irish soccer team haven't achieved in the way maybe that, you know, the GAA achieves in hurling and Gaelic football, and the way rugby players have been achieving in the national team, it is sad in a sense for Irish soccer that it has lost that momentum, do you think? Because love it.
Yeah, just one thing that people I don't think generally appreciate, they may understand it but don't appreciate it. Like last night, getting a point out of a game with the current world champions.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, much was made of the fact that Germany was short the likes of Lahm and Schweinsteiger, who were injured and or retired. Ireland was short Seamus Coleman, Richard Dunn recently retired, and a couple of others. So for us to be short, us, Ireland, to be short those, is certainly much harder than Germany to be short a couple. But a very important thing people should never forget: football, soccer, is not our game.
No.
In fact, on the list of things, undoubtedly Gaelic football is the number one game in the country.
Yeah.
Number two would be hurling, probably, almost certainly. Then rugby's coming with a charge in the last decade. Mm. Golf, horse racing.
Mm.
And then maybe soccer comes in. Mm. And to think that we are expecting as a people that we'll hold the world champions and the European champions, God, we have a cheek. And yet the fellas are able to do it.
Away from home.
Away from home. So long as there's a few pints and a few women, so they don't care. What do you think, Paul? You'd agree with that. This is Paul here.
Paul who?
Ah, he's just Paul.
Hi, Paul. Tell us about Paul.
Yeah, Paul formerly played for Ireland.
Whoa, let's throw them.
Table football. Push halfpenny.
Pool table.
Push halfpenny, yeah.
Push
halfpenny. Come on, Miriam. If you think I'm going to marry you in that condition. How many children do you have at the moment?
Eight. Eight. And my twin daughters are there in the front row.
Hello, twin daughters. How are you? Would you like to have another brother or sister?
That two. There's two empty chairs.
Yeah, there's two empty chairs
here.
No, but in terms of sport, you both have had beautiful careers. Would you say that? You've had wonderful careers.
I loved it.
You both loved it.
I'd love to be 30 again.
And would you?
I would love it. I would love, for many reasons.
But why not see?
You're on a one-track tonight, Jimmy.
I have a one-track mind. Yeah. I have.
Now, Jimmy arrived very early this evening and he rested.
Okay.
Yeah, he wants to be up till morning.
Miriam, your brother is a lovely man.
My brother?
Yeah, Mario.
But like in a short while, I have young guns, they're calling it, coming on, some of the greatest sports stars we have in this country. When people ask either of you for advice in life in terms, no, we'll start with me all. Life advice, both I suppose in terms of loving the sport, wanting to succeed in sport, and maybe wanting to live a good life. What do you say, Mia?
Yes, don't.
Go, Jimmy.
No, don't criticise and knock anybody.
Okay.
Yeah. I think that is vitally, vitally important. I heard somebody on the television yesterday, can't remember his name or I tell you, saying that Ireland shouldn't be playing
Eamon Dunphy.
Yeah. I don't know. But saying we have no chance if your man is playing midfield. Now that fella he was talking about has a wife, as a child, as a mother, as a father, as a grandfather. Think of how they felt at that moment. Yeah. That this little fella they brought into the world 30 something years ago, and this fella is on the television criticizing him. That should be a definite no-no. And if it was in charge, he'd never do it again.
But I would say from our line of business that you're always to remember there are two sides to it. And there are people listening and they'd be supporting one or other or none to give as true and as fair a description of what's happening as you can. And above all, and it's a thing I read in the autobiography of the great Scottish rugby Bill McLaren, one sentence that I liked, he said, he always listened back to his own commentaries when he got a chance. Not to see did he do a good job, but just in case I wasn't fair to everyone. And if he felt, having listened back to it, that he wasn't fair to A or B or C, he'd make it his business to let him know that he wasn't fair, that he had made a mistake. Okay. I think to be fair, and above all, don't take yourself too seriously.
In life.
In anything.
And remember, it is sport. It's not a life and death exercise. Yeah. It is sport. Yeah. You take Mark about whom and for whom this evening is taking place. There's a lot. Look at the important things in Mark's life. Yeah. Not as to whether a man missed an open goal or not.
Yeah.
Not at all.
Yeah.
It only matters on the day. It matters when you're going home and fellas are saying outside Crow Park, is that the best game you ever saw? And whether it was or not, you say, yes, it was. And they've forgotten about it 2 weeks later. And that's as it should be, because it's only sport. There's no use playing golf. This man is a regular golfer and a good one. No use throwing the clubs away when you miss the shot. It's not the bloody club's fault. And I know what I'm talking about. I was a golfer of substance in my time.
Oh, yeah, a noted golfer.
No substance.
But just on that point, blaming the club. I remember 1960, the Canada Cup was played in Port Marlon, which was the World Cup at the time. And there was a Spaniard who was Angel Miguel. He was a great player, but he was putting badly all day. And on the 18th, when he had missed another one, put it in, then put it across his knee, bent it in two, threw it into a bush and said loudly, "She play no more golf."
Jimmy, final question to you, because you mentioned Mark there, and we know tonight is about Irish motor neuron disease, and you are their patron, and of course you are their patron, as many people know, because you tragically lost your son to it.
Yeah.
So,
I miss Paul. I miss Paul every day. I missed him over the weekend talking about the football. I missed him last night because he'd be there criticising, but not in public. He wouldn't be, because he played football himself. He was a professional footballer.
Very high level.
Yeah, he was a very good footballer.
And he was silver medalist in the Irish Cross Country Championship. He was the Irish 10-pin bowling champion 6 years in a row. And he played four handicap golf, so he was fairly decent at loads of things. Played Dublin under 16s football at Croke Park.
Great football.
So he loved sport. He absolutely loved it. And when he was 49 years old, he was only 2 years younger than me. When he was 49 years old, he got this incredible disease, motor neuron. And he didn't know anything about it at the time. Mark, I'm sorry about this. I was asked a question. I'm going to answer it. But you'll know the answers anyway. So I'm not pulling the rug from under your feet. I'm just saying he went to them and said, yes, I've heard of it. He said in response to, "Have you heard of this?" And he said, first and I think anyone would ask, "How long have I got?" And they said, "The most, 3 years." 1 year, 5 months later, he was dead. But whilst he was still able to speak, which didn't happen in the last 3-4 months, while still able to speak, he knew that there was no cure for this. Not in the foreseeable future, anyway. And there was nobody knew how you got it or what the reasons for it were. So he got onto the hospital himself, to the Beaumont Hospital, and suggested that he'd like to donate, bequeath, I think that'd be the right word, his brain when he died, as he was going to do shortly. Well, a few days later, he did die. And the day after he died, they came out from the hospital and took whatever cells they needed. And today, that's in the brain bank at Beaumont.
Okay.
Now, wouldn't it be something that some years down the line, a cure in whole or in part was found for this dreadful disease, and that he was even partially responsible for it? That is the greatest legacy that any man can leave. Paul, I still love you.
Oh. Ladies and gentlemen, I have to move on to more legends, but Micheal O Muircheartaigh, Jimmy McGee, it's always a pleasure. Go meet him, Mahogu of Gulair. Next up, we have a musical treat. We have a local beautiful young woman, Karen Kelly. She's from Collession here in Carlow. She studied performance in Maynooth under the wonderful Virginia Kerr. She's sung in St. Peter's Basilica in Rome, the Royal Albert Hall in London, the National Concert Hall in Dublin, and the Three Arena. Give a really warm welcome to Karen Kelly. Micheal and Jimmy.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jimmy.
Each day I live, I want to be a day to give the best of me. I'm only one, but not alone. My finest day is yet unknown. I broke my heart for every regain to taste the sweet. I face the pain, I rise and fall, yet through it all, this much remains. I want one moment in time when I'm more than I thought I could be, when all of my dreams are a heartbeat away and the answers, they're all up to me. Give me one moment in time when I'm racing with destiny, then in that one moment of time I will feel eternity. I've lived to be the very best. I want it all, no time for less. I've laid the plans, now lay the chance here in my hands. Give me one moment in time when I'm more than I thought I could be, when all of my dreams are a heartbeat away and the answers, they're all up to me. Give me one moment in time when I'm racing with death.
Collection. My God, it's not just the GAA players. Well done, Karen. Okay, now we have the young guns, as they're called. I have four of them coming up. First up, will you give a really warm welcome? He's a GAA superstar who's made his mark on the Dublin squad since he was first introduced in 2010. Since joining, he's won two All-Ireland senior football medals, two All-Stars, and he was voted in 2013, just last year, All-Star Player of the Year. Put your hands together for Micheal Darragh MaCauley.
there and turn her down the rocky road and all the way to double a pint for Lolly Bye.
I keep going. Our next young gun, well, he's one of Ireland and the UK's by a mile most successful jockeys. He's ridden over 2,000 winners throughout his career. He's won both the Grand National and Cheltenham Gold Cup twice. He's also been awarded top jockey in Cheltenham on 8 occasions and is also Cheltenham's most successful rider with over 40 wins at the course throughout his career. And to crown it all, he's also earned the title of Irish champion jockey on 8 occasions. Give an amazingly warm welcome to Ruby Walsh. Okay, keep going. Next up, hot on the heels of another magnificent All-Ireland win, our next guest is regarded as one of the linchpins of the Kilkenny senior hurling defence, and Kilkenny cannot lose. This man is without doubt one of the GAA elite, being one of only 12 people in GAA history to earn at least 8 All-Ireland medals in either football or hurling. Give an incredibly warm welcome to Jackie Tyrell. Wow, the Liam McCarthy, we'll discuss it in a moment. I keep going, so I have one more to bring on. Our next and final young gun hasn't got too far to travel tonight, so you can guess who he is. He's described in the rugby world as a rampaging ball of destruction. He's had the honour of playing rugby at the highest level for Leinster, Ireland, the Lions, and arguably he is the best back row forward on the planet. Give a welcome to the one and only Tullo Tang, Sean O'Brien. Okay, first of all, so much talent, but two obvious injuries. Okay, first of all, what happened to your hand?
I've been in the wars lately. I was playing a match in my club and I decided to hit a fella's elbow somehow, and I managed to break my thumb. So, yeah, it wasn't great now, so it's probably a good timing, though.
Very good time. How long will it take to recover?
I'll be better once Sandy comes around, so.
Yeah, that's good. Sean, I know we know a bit about your shoulder, but tell us anyway.
Yeah, I had shorter done again last week.
Is your microphone working? Can you hear him? No, I know. Is it working? No. Okay, what I'll do is they'll come and fix your mic. Somebody wonderful will come from Sound Effects. Shout for the moment, Sean. Ruby, let's go on. I mean, to talk about injuries, Ruby Walsh, apart from being the most brilliant guy at what you do, just how many injuries have you had in your career? List a few of them.
Well, I know a thumb never stopped me riding, so I'm thinking your man is a bit of a fairy here beside me. I'll tell you a better one. I'm riding in hospital in Cheltenham last March, and the phone rings, it's 087 number. The heaviest lad in the end comes on the phone. He says, "You've done your shoulder or whatever." So yeah, he says, "Look," he says, "a great surgeon in Dublin called Hannon Mullins. You should go and see him." So I say, "Grand, come on from Cheltenham, get on the phone Monday morning, find this man in Sanctuary, Hannon Mullins, go get my shoulder fixed, do all the rehab." So I'm at home last week listening to the radio. Your man gets injured again. He'd never gone to Hannon Mullins. Then he heads off to London or America or somewhere, thinking, this is interesting. Thank God mine won't. And thank God he didn't follow his own advice. So,
okay, on that, Sean, why didn't you go to this guy in Sandry?
I might have to go to Hannah Mullet's home.
I don't think it's working.
I didn't go to Hannah Mullet anyways. Because he was away on holidays at the time.
Better excuse, please.
Jackie, when he's talking, kind of hand him over. You can see the mic on you. Jack, yeah. Just seriously, because no one will hear, Sean. Go.
Jackie. Hannon, I wanted to get it done pretty quickly after it happened, especially to not let scar tissue and stuff form around the joint. So, Hannon was away on 10 days holidays at one point, and all right, Jackie, thanks. This is comical now. Hannon was away on 10 days holidays, and so we went over to his a fella he trained with called Len Funk in Manchester, and he's one of the best around as well. But fortunately, after that, I got an infection a couple of days later, and you know, things didn't heal as they should have, and had to be redone in the heel of the hunt. So that's where we are.
Yeah, it's good, but you'll be better soon. That's not working either, but we get it working. Jackie, in terms of, do you know what's interesting I found? How amazing is it to keep winning as part of Kilkenny? I mean, what is in the water in Kilkenny, first of all, that you produce such great hurlers?
I suppose it's a lot of things. It's obviously a great manager in Brian Cody, but you know, a very special group of guys coming together who are very ambitious and very hungry for success. And I suppose when you win at one All-Ireland, you get the feeling that you witness at the end of it. It's like a drug, and you just get hooked on it, and you're addicted straight away. And you just want more and more, and it just kind of stems from there.
And is it true that Brian Cody taught you in school as well?
Yeah, I had Brian in St. Patrick's Delascalle in primary school. I had him for 3 years there as well. So that's kind of where the hurling originated, really, and just went on from there.
And I mean, it's an open secret. We're going to meet him later. How is he such an amazing manager? I mean, what is it about him?
I suppose his desire and his hunger and his passion for the game, and he wants to succeed, and he wants to get the best out of his team, and he's a great leader, and you know, he's just, no matter how much success he has, his 2 feet remain firmly on the ground, you know, and he's just a great GA man. But you know, I suppose I can't give away all the secrets of Uncle Kenny the minute. We're not done yet, hopefully, now. But you know, he's just an overall great man, and any time you talk to him, you can just see the passion. You see him on the sideline. You know, he hits every ball with us, and you know, he just puts everything into it.
Ruby, from your point of view, I've interviewed you a number of times, but I was asking Micheal and Jimmy in terms of their career, you know, maybe high moments. Is it impossible for you to have best moments of your career? Because there've been so many great moments, but is there one that meant more to you than another one?
Definitely. When I won the national in Papillon in 2000, it would definitely be something for me. I suppose on a personal level, because Dad trained him, that I'd probably never get again. But that's just because blood is always thicker than water, and I rode him for Dad. I'd been out for quite a while the winter before with a broken leg. I was only 20, and at the time, Ireland didn't win Grand National. Sorry, Bobby Joe had won the year before, but since from the time I was born, there hadn't been an Irish Grand National winner. So, I mean, to even riding the age of Grand National was amazing, and to go and win it, I was only 20 in my first attempt on a horse trained by Dad. Yeah, it was a fairy tale. So that'll never be tough, but I've been lucky, and you know, I do appreciate all the good days I've had, and I've had a lot of them.
But is there people are talking about psychology in sport, especially with, say, younger sporting people like you guys. Is there, I mean, do you psych yourself up, as well as obviously having a natural talent, how much is it also that you psych yourselves into believing you can do it? Like, when you see that big thing in front of you and you've got to run down and on a horse.
Everyone will think we're probably different. You ask the four of us the same question, yeah, and we'll give you a different answer. I think, fuck it, you can either do it or you can't. it's as simple as that. And I think the more you think about it, then the more you complicate it, the more chance you have of getting it wrong. The more you worry about it, you're going to be right or you're wrong. You're human. And if you're afraid to make a mistake, you have no chance of winning. You're human. You're going to make mistakes. So don't worry about them. Just get over it.
So interesting. For you, Micheal Darragh, in terms of when you go on to the pitch and you're psyching yourself up, do you just say, fuck it, you can do it? It's a whole new way I'm going to introduce prime time tomorrow night.
pretty sure that's the first time Miriam O Callaghan's ever cursed, isn't it? Yeah, look, I suppose everyone kind of has their own thing. He said the fours will probably have different answers. Yeah. And even within the Dublin team, like, some lads will be kind of big into maybe discussing with psychologists and their different kind of nicks and knacks. But Yeah, look, I think Ruby said it. Some people have a kind of ruthless streak in them, and when it comes to winning, and I suppose the lads on the panel here, would you won't get much better, that are probably kind of born with it. Obviously, look, there's a huge amount of commitment and work rate that goes into that on top of that as well, and there's always a stroke of luck as well, but I suppose I've been quite lucky in my career as well that I've managed to get my fair share of it, yeah.
Jackie?
No, I wouldn't like kind of go focus. But I'm going to use that in Kilkenny maybe, but it is usually psychological, and it's about being positive, and you know, you're always going to have doubts and fears, but it's putting them to the back of your head. And you know, I suppose the thing I love doing is playing hurling and a big challenge in front of you and all there, and finally that's where you want to be. You want to be put up against the best. You want to see if you can survive, if you can strive in that kind of situation. But I would agree with Ruby, like, you know, being safe and, you know, playing a cage, you know, eventually you're going to be found out. It'll only get you so far. You've got to be ruthless. You got to come a stage where you got to take a chance. And you will make mistakes, but as a team effort, if everyone has the same psychology as that and is backing each other up, you know, an honest mistake won't beat you. But you got to be ruthless. At the end of the day, it's going to be you or him. Hmm. It's do or die.
And you, Sean?
Yeah.
No. Yeah,
it's similar to the lads, to be honest. I think for us, for me personally, I like to be prepared as best I can. And that's, I suppose, throughout the whole week, you know, eating, training hard, you know my game knowledge. And you'll find out from Joe later, you know, he's nearly a psychologist himself, I think. He doesn't tell anyone that, but he is. But and the fear then of not winning and not being the best in your position or on the field at the time, I think drives me as well, you know. And I think all the lads sitting here, you know, certainly have that at times. I think in their careers, the fear, you know, having that little bit of fear does drive you on that extra little bit.
And I asked, you know, Jackie about Brian Cody, but Joe Schmidt is the same. I mean, you're a solo artist, really, Ruby, but when you're part of a team and you have a manager like Joe Schmidt, does that make a huge difference? And if you're down at the break at half time, does what he say to you actually make a significant difference?
Yeah, you know, to give you an example, I suppose when Joe was over Leinster, the Northampton game, the final that we played, you know, the big thing I think that I believe now is if we follow instructions from Joe and we execute and we all know what we're supposed to be doing, we'll be in a position to win the game. And, you know, that day, for instance, we didn't do what he had told us. But, you know, it was the calmest probably dressing room I've ever been in at half time. And we knew we had made more mistakes in that first half than we did the whole year. And if we just got back to our basics and back to what we had planned during the week and stuck to our process, you know, it'd come good. And, you know the results spoke for itself then. So, you know, he's obviously a man that sticks to detail and having a system in place. And you know, if we execute that in a good manner, it's you know, it should be ours.
Is it lonelier when you're not part of a team, Ruby?
I don't know, because I've never really been part of a team. Although, yeah, you are part of a team. Like, I work for Willie Mullins, and yeah. I worked for Paul Nicholls in the past, and you're involved in that whole team environment, as in the lads in the yard and everybody else. But I don't know. I suppose you've 14 other lads in these other teams robbing the glory off you as well, so you're on your own. You're on your own.
I love you, Ruby. But actually, talking about Brian and Joe, I mean, Willie Mullins, do you improve when you work for somebody as brilliant as he is?
Yeah, Willie definitely instills confidence in you. Mm. Like, you can be standing somewhere like Cheltenham, the biggest week of the year, and instead of giving the instructions, he'll just say to you, you'll get something wrong, just get over it, go on with it. You hand him the saddle for the first race, and he'll say, you know what you're doing. There you are, it's up to you, away with you. He trusts me, I trust him, and away you go. I think you can overcomplicate things, and he keeps it as simple as possible. Puts the ball in your court and trusts you. And I must say, I like that.
Mm. When you were young, yeah. He's also listening to you right now.
Yeah, I'm sure I've told him in the past at some stage, but yeah, well, I know he's listening to me, but sure, I've worked for him since I was 16. I'm sure we've had this conversation at some stage in the past, but it does give you confidence that someone is willing to back your judgment and let you run with the ideas you have. I suppose that maybe that's different from Sean having to have it spelled out and what he has to do all day and all. You know, it's very different.
It's easy, I suppose, when you're handed the best horses in the country every day.
When you're playing beside Jamie Heaslip and in front of Brian O'Driscoll, it's very difficult.
Driscoll's retired, Ruby. Sorry.
And you haven't played since you retired.
We're all friends now, come on.
Do you know what people often say as well in life? It's how you cope with adversity. If something goes wrong and you come back stronger, that you can be better at what you're doing. Jackie, have there ever been moments in your career where you felt you really did something wrong or missed something or messed something up and you came back stronger after it?
I suppose growing up, when I was young, when I was 17, 18, I would have had some bad days with Kilkenny minors and Kilkenny under 21s. And I suppose you're thinking, like, I would love turning. I was like, you know, is this really for me? Am I as good as I think I am? And I suppose, as the lads talk about, fears and doubts creep in and that, but I suppose it's about staying true to yourself and just working hard. And, you know, if you work hard enough, eventually the breaks will come. And the day that I got my chance with Kilkenny, got in, and, you know, Brian is an unbelievable man for putting faith. And he said, look, if you train hard, you'll get your game. And that's what happened. And I got confidence on it and just went on from there. And, you know, I suppose last year would have been very difficult for us. You know, we would have been used to being contesting the All-Irelands, and to lose, to go to the All-Ireland qualifying stage was very difficult. But, you know, once again, it's about being true to yourself and sticking to the process that the lads are talking about and believing in the coach that you have, and just keeping the head down, and, you know, eventually you get the rewards.
Yeah. And Sean, you, is there a moment in your career where you felt a bit low or felt you weren't doing what you should be doing or did something wrong?
Jeez, I'm feeling a bit low after that. After Ruby attacking me there. I've only been out 10 months, but anyway, sorry. I'll be back in some such. I know. I think, you know, obviously when things happen like that, I won't get into details of it now, just in case he comes back again at me. But, when things happen like that, it's obviously disappointing for a day or two, but, you know, what can you do? You get on with things, you look forward and you take positives, and, you know, everything happens for a reason as well. And that, well, I believe that anyway. So, you know, this rest might do me the world of good, and, you know, we've a big year ahead of us and a lot of rugby to be played. So, you know, I'll be back at some stage.
Do you think we could? Of course you are. Does the outside part of your life, the fact that you're a farmer, does that help you kind of, I don't know, relax or put things in perspective if things go wrong sometimes?
Yeah, it does. It definitely gets me out of the bubble, I suppose. We're in Dublin and you know, it's nice to come down home and, you know, go for a walk with the dogs, you know, get out on the farm, do whatever, you know, go for a spin in the tractor. All that really exciting stuff. But you know, it is good. And you unwind and you know, you can switch off, and it's very important. I think, you know, I'd say all the lads here at some point switch off, whether it be holidays or whatnot. So it's important to do that as well and freshen the mind up. But, you know, it's great to have, I suppose, be so close to Dublin, family and stuff as well for me personally. So it's very good to get down here.
And Ruby, in that thing of just maybe low moments or us being defined or improved by coping with things that go wrong?
I'd say, yeah, every time you're put onto another stretcher into the back of another ambulance, you're thinking, what the hell am I doing this for? But that goes away, the physical pain, they fix you up, patch you up, and then you sit there and start watching the television and horses are winning, you should be riding. Like, I'm sure the lads are the same, matches are played, they should be playing in, and someone else is winning in their position. It's the same thing, you just want to get back. But yeah, every time you get, well, not every time, but there's certain times you get slapped off the ground, you're thinking, why am I doing this?
You, Micheal Darragh?
Yeah, no, yeah, I suppose. Like, I suppose it's just important that the good days kind of outweigh the bad days. And yeah, look, as I said, like, we lost to Donegal this year, and then I went on to break my hand, and obviously not in a great place now. But I suppose if I look back 12 months ago, we were after winning the whole lot. Like, so yeah, look, like, you have good days and bad days, but, like, you just have to. I suppose those good days are so good. That's what kind of drives you on. And people always ask about, like, well, like, is there anything special that the manager, like, talks about at halftime and the All-Ireland final and stuff? But, like, to be honest, like, the hard work's done a long time before that, back in January, back running up mountains and all that sort of carry on. So, yeah, look, it's I think the lads here just kind of drive themselves on in the early season, and it's that kind of hard work that keeps the kind of good memories coming in. So, it's all good.
Was it sweeter at all, considering you lost to Donegal, when there was so much criticism of Jim McGuinness and the way he plays the game?
No, it was none. to be honest. All we wanted to do was get our hands on the other version of that now. So he's just rubbing it in now. I forgot about it for a while. People talk about that, but it means nothing at all. Kerry didn't play maybe the football that they used to play in the All Ireland final, but I can guarantee you now, Kerry couldn't care less about that. Kerry are happy now because they have Sam Maguire back in Kerry, and that's all that matters at the end of the day. So now look, Kerry did what they have to do, and they deserved. And Donegal were full credit to beat us as well. So we obviously weren't on the ball that day. So look, it's going to be another big one next year, and we're looking forward to it.
But you all love each other's sports. Like, Jackie, would you say when Ruby rides or when Sean is playing, obviously you'd watch Dublin probably, would you watch every sport?
No.
I was so sure you were going to say, of course.
I would watch rugby and I'd watch county football. I'm not into horse racing at all. I asked Brian earlier who the lads were coming into the room. I knew of Ruby and I knew of Willie Mullins, but no, I don't. American football, I love watching American football now. So.
Hockey? As Jimmy McGee, no. You miss that. Sean, would you watch Ruby?
I would, of course. I'd watch him very careful now. I'd be a big fan of all sport, and especially, you know, the three lads sport here beside us. You know, hurling this year I thought was unbelievable. The football was very good, and you know, the racing's getting going now again, and I love watching it all, to be honest.
When you were a little boy, did you always hope and think you could be the level of success you are today as a sports guy?
Probably not at the very start, to be honest with you. I was playing a lot of football at home, and I was playing a bit of hurling as well, and I was too big to ride horses, so... I went on about my business of picking up a rugby ball, and when I got to 16, I suppose, the first time I was picked for the South East Leinster, and selected on that, I thought to myself, here, I'm going to give this a good rattle now and, you know, get the head down. And that's what I done. And, you know, to be honest, I'm one of the lucky ones that got through. There was players that were playing with me that were probably a bit more talented than me at the time and you know, fell away or maybe didn't develop as quickly as others. So it's especially when you're playing club rugby, I think there's a good bit of luck involved in it. You know, the school system is so strong now throughout Ireland, it's massive.
And how much is it talent versus hard work? Like, can you have the talent if you don't put in the work, you mightn't get there or not?
No, I wouldn't agree with that. As I said, I think there's loads of talent out there, but if they're not going to work hard, you know, they won't get to the very top. You know, you have to have, you know, I'd say I was probably a talented ball carrier was my thing, and I tried to keep that the whole way through my career, but I wasn't good and making quick decisions, or I wasn't good at you know, in the line-out. Still not great at that, mind you, but, you know, certain things like that. And when you get into a system like we're in above, it's, you know, you have to learn fast and you have to think quickly on your feet as well. You know, you make decisions, you know, instantly. And if you have to think about them, it's probably too late or you know, you're going to make a mistake. So, you know, all that stuff I've developed over the last, you know, 10 or so years or a little bit more. So it's... you know, but again, all down to hard work, I think. You know, I've always had that mantra, you know, keep working hard, keep working hard, keep working hard. I'd be telling myself that in the field some days, you know, when you're doing, you know, wet nights or whatever, and or wet days, and you're on the field for hours. So, yeah, work hard, I reckon, and, you know, the rest will fall into place.
Ruby, do you watch Sean when he's playing?
I do. I love rugby. Played it as a kid. I actually wanted to be a rugby player, but I was too small. I played for this. I had one of those South East Leinster tries as well, but that was as far as I got.
But I do. I have huge admiration for her. I think it's an unbelievably skillful sport. I thought the Ireland final was the most boring match I ever watched in my life. Like watching paint dry, but there was a winner, of course. But no, I'd be more a rugby man than I would be a GA man. And I have great respect for the Irish rugby team and the Leinster, Munster, Ulster, and even Connacht are doing great this season as well. But I'd be more a Munster man than a GA man. When you come from Kildare, you usually don't have a lot to shout about in GA anyway, so you jump on the back of rugby.
And Micheal Darragh, because there's so much competition, I suppose, between rugby and Gaelic football or hurling, how did you choose to go to GAA? In other words, did you ever think about rugby or not?
I played a bit of rugby, to be honest. When I was growing up, I wasn't much used. I didn't even know the rules. They used to just stick me on the wing and then run in a straight line. But yeah, basketball was my game kind of growing up. So I would have kind of played that heavily until I was about 18, and then the GAA coaches were managed to get their claws into me, and I stuck with that. So you know, there is huge competition. Like I suppose the Leinster team is huge around the area, and soccer and rugby, and so those kids are spoiled these days with all sorts. I was saying, I was after getting involved in the horse racing game myself. We're after looking at a horse there last month, so I might have to get a slip Ruby, a little tenner here, to try and jump on top of it now. That's more of a donkey than a horse, like, it goes anyway, so.
But are you studying as well?
I'm just finished primary school teaching. So I was at that, like, so I had a busy 2 years now, because it was a postgrad course, and I'm trying to juggle the Dublin football, which is nearly every night of the week as well. So it was tough, but we managed to get over the line anyway.
Because there is still that incredibly extraordinary side to Gaelic football and hurling, that it's an amateur sport. Do you ever look at maybe your friends in other sports and think?
Yeah, no, I see Sean O'Brien lounging around Dublin Shopping Centre going time to time now. It's tough. Like it probably is the big difference. Like Sean probably gets up and goes for a swim, and then the rest of us could probably go to work. So probably goes for a few lunches as well. So that's the way it is. Like everyone knew what they were getting into when they started playing GAA. Like, and I know people talk about bringing professionalism into it and stuff, but it's definitely not going to happen in my day anyway. And it is what it is, and I suppose that's kind of what makes the GAA great.
Yeah,
that, like, people aren't getting transfers to Kildare, definitely not Kildare anyway. And people are playing for the pride of their jersey and stuff. So
I think Sean wants to come back in that.
Yeah, just to clarify, I was in Dundrum trying to find a pair of those skinny jeans you want and a leather jacket.
You've been doing well to get into these ones.
No sizes fit me in there. No sizes.
The student, the wannabe student and the rich student. that's the way it is.
Silence.
You don't have your own show, actually. Jackie, do you ever think about that? Because I suppose people like you have your own busy lives, and then you go and you play and you win the All-Ireland and the Liam McCarthy.
Yeah, well, I think the amateur ethos in the GA is what is beautiful about it. It's brilliant that, you know, we've all jobs to go to, and we can't be lounging around Dundrum every day of the week. But it is brilliant, man. I suppose when you think about it, we're all so lucky we're in our sports and we've been successful and we love what we're doing. And when you see what's going on in the world, even tonight, you know, you've got to be thankful for a lot of things that are going on in our careers. Just being able to, as we've seen in the clip, to get up every day and, you know, to go training with a team and that. I think that's hugely important, and we do take it for granted. And you know, when you have great days in Croke Park, it's unbelievable. And when we've had success and you've trained really hard, it's really sweet. But you know, it's a lot to be thankful.
Yeah, and to give advice, if there were, like, there's a couple of lovely little young boys here in the front row, who's very patient there. Jackie's only 8. Starting with you, Ruby, what advice, if like somebody young wanted to get into sport, what would you say is the best way to go about succeeding?
You have to follow your dream for a start. Definitely. And I suppose in an individual sport like mine, it's pretty simple. You have to work harder than the fella in front of you in order to get above him. And then you have to follow your dream and keep believing in it.
You need courage as well. I mean, I think it's very courageous. I've said this to you before, that you've had so many injuries and fall and you get right back up. Is it not very scary the next time you get back up?
There's a fine line between courage and stupidity. And someone's there, we cross it too often. But if it's a dream, you love your dream. If you're afraid of your dream, it's a nightmare. So you follow your dream.
Do you love horses? I remember interviewing with your dad, Ted, and he actually was crying about a horse. I forget which one. Was it Poppy on a horse that had died?
No, he's still alive. He's Comanche called. He's a bit soft, though. Yeah. Comes across on he is actually a bit soft. But, yeah, of course you love horses. You couldn't work with them for as long and regard them as much as we do without loving them. You'd have to love them, because otherwise they'd just drive you mental. But, yeah, you do love them. I love them, most definitely.
And Sean, for the young boys here sitting in the front row, because to a lot of young boys I'm saying, you guys are all heroes. So, to give advice?
Yeah, I'd say similar to Ruby, you know, follow your dreams, you know, work hard. I think no matter what you want in life, lads, you know, keep going and keep going after it. And, you know, it's very simple. I think if you want something bad enough in life, you know, you'll get there eventually, persistence, and you know, that hard work will pay off for you.
And Micheal Darragh MaCauley?
My full title.
Yeah, full title.
Yeah, no, I suppose, look, I suppose when I was kind of 12 years old playing football, even up till 17, 18, not a person in the crowd would have picked me out as being one of the best players with my club, and definitely wouldn't have been kind of scouted for Dublin. And I suppose I was always I worked very hard, and no one will ever say I'm one of the most talented players in the GAA at the moment, because I'm not, and I know that, but I work a lot harder than the fella next to me most of the time. So for me, it's coming out to a lot of hard work, and it has to be a passion. You have to enjoy what you're doing, and if, like, maybe it's not sport, maybe it's something else, but for follow your passion, I suppose, is the main thing, yeah.
Jackie?
I would say most certainly enjoy it. If you don't enjoy what you're doing, and if you're not, you know, if it's like a chore that you have to go and do it, you shouldn't be doing it. You know, I love hurling, Sean loves lounge around Dunn's home. Mickey Dara loves football. We all have our passions, but you've got to enjoy it. If you see it as a chore, I was cute enough to be like, he's not answering that for me, you know. But yeah, so just get out there and enjoy the sport. There's nothing like enjoying it and creating a bond with the team.
Sean, you've bought a pub, haven't you, with some of the guys in Ballsbridge?
No.
Yeah. It's actually moved to the shopping centre now.
No, it's the old Bellamy's, isn't it, there? You bought
Bellamy's. It's called The Bridge now. Yeah.
What's it called?
The Bridge. 1859.
What's the 1859 about?
That was when the building was originally built. And when we were stripping back some of the outside of it and inside, it was implanted in one of the walls. So that's why we said we'd go with that. But yeah, that's up and running now the last 3 weeks. And it's been very good so far. Big eye-opener to all of us as well. The four of us are involved. You know, we're involved kind of in everything. And yeah, I'm looking forward to getting the head down into that as well.
Have you done any bartending there?
I pulled a pint the first night of the opening, yeah, so I swallowed it as well, mind you. So. So. You have to make sure the beer is good in these places.
And when you're kind of setting up something like that as a business, is it because you're kind of thinking ahead to the future for your career, or do you end up just, do you only think about the World Cup next year? I mean, do you think ahead more?
No, I suppose for me, it's things that, you know, I'm interested in and things that are right for me personally. And, you know, an investment like that in the area, obviously, you know, is a no-brainer. But, you know, I'm thinking ahead all the time. I'm back in college this year and do business studies, and you know, that's the route I'm going now. And you know, I believe well, the farmer's got a good plug yesterday, mind you, in the budget. But you know, I don't think it's something that I'm going to be able to go full time at or to make a living out of with the amount of land we have at home. So you know, it'll always be something I have, but I'm looking forward to more the business world, hopefully at the end of my career.
And I know some of the ladies here are like, how's your love life?
She's just a tough one now. No, it's my love life's very good. I'm going out with a girl now, just over five months. So very, very happy, and yeah. So, what else would you like to know?
I think that's answered it for them. That's absolutely fine. When's your next big? No.
No. Yeah, Miriam, you're not talking to Jimmy McGee now. Like.
No. But for instance, you're talking, just to wrap up all of you, you said earlier, I think it was Jackie or Sean said, it's important to go on holiday, or it was you, Sean, to take time out and forget. But do any of you ever, like Ruby, do you ever forget about what you do, even when you take a holiday?
Yeah, I suppose I do now. I might not when I was younger, but would definitely would now. But when you go on holidays now, for me anyway, with three kids, it's much different. You get time to forget about it, because if you're thinking about what's happening in Stratford, one of them is in the pool, you have to forget about it. You know what I mean? That's what probably switches you off. Yeah, I suppose for me, as I've gotten older and I have three daughters, that definitely they allow you time to switch off.
Do you think any of them might ride like Katie?
I hope not.
Do you really mean that?
Most definitely, yeah.
That's interesting. Why?
I know what I've put my body through. I know what it's like watching Katie riding. I know she won the Kerry National last week, but I worry about her riding, and I most definitely wouldn't be able to watch my own kids ride.
Interesting. Micheal Darragh from Micheal Darragh, do you manage? What do you do? How's your love life, by the way? Because I know Ruby's married.
Mine's in the room, so.
Oh, great!
I'm under pressure. She's down there somewhere, Rosie.
Hi, Rosie.
At least yours has a name.
Sean, don't mind him!
Jesus. Sean's under pressure.
I like to keep my private life private for a reason, so. Her name is Denise, so Ruby. Just so you know.
Good job you got it out there, because in the morning she'd say, you couldn't even say my name.
I'm have to pick up a few brownie points there now.
Yeah.
Switching off? To switch off. Look, I suppose it's tough. I know at the moment people just keep telling me, on the bright side, take a rest. Like, you have injuries now, take a rest. But I suppose it's tough, and like, I'm after wheeling out the exercise bike and I'm racing away at that, trying to keep fit. It's just one of those things that you've been doing it for so long and every day that it just becomes kind of instinctive. So it is hard to switch off, but look, I suppose everyone likes to try and get a few holidays and try. It's important, you know what I mean? Because it is intense and people are asking about it constantly and stuff. So I think it is good for the mind there to switch off for a while. Anyway, we're heading away next week to Boston for a while, so I'm sure I might be able to switch off over there.
And Jackie, for you, actually, how's your love life?
It's great.
To unwind.
Switch off. I suppose a few days after the All-Ireland there, I didn't know where I was, so it's definitely... I definitely forgot what I was doing that week anyway, but... You go on holidays and you kick back and you enjoy yourself. You know, we all have long years and it's tough training and that. So most definitely, it's very important to unwind and psych yourself up for the following year.
And you, Sean, do you just spend it in Dundrum? That's really...
The last couple of years, actually, Vegas has been the destination. So you don't be long about forgetting about things over there. So it's it's very important, obviously, to switch off, and whether it be going away on holidays or getting down home or just getting away from the whole thing and switching off the mind for a week or two is, you know, very good. And then you're ready to rock then again, you know. I think, as Micheal Darragh said, that you're kind of training every day and putting your body through so much. After a week or two, you do start to miss it as well, of that routine and staying fit, you know, and fresh. So it's... But it's good to unwind.
Well, I just want to say before I close, the four of you came here tonight. You're at the top of your field. You're like household names. You're incredibly modest, all of you. And I know Mark and his family are so appreciative here. Ladies and gentlemen, let's give them a round of applause. Please. Take a break for 20 minutes, and there's going to be a raffle, so if you can support it, that would be great. Have a drink and we'll come back with more legends. Thanks a million. Hi everybody. I have to say, I thought that was one of the best television shows I've ever presented. Myself. Anyway, before I bring up our next legends, we have another musical act. Des Willoughby is... I've lost my voice. Des Willoughby is from... Wait. Right, Des Willoughby is from Coolboy in County Wicklow. He's a beautiful tenor. He studied singing with the renowned Veronica Don, who I've interviewed many times, was wonderful. He's going to sing for us tonight. He's sung extensively throughout Ireland and the US, both as a soloist and with his brothers, who are also beautiful singers, the Willoughby brothers. Give a really warm welcome to the wonderful Des Willoughby.
God on high, hear my prayer. In my need, you have always been there. He is your afraid, let him rest, heaven bless, bring him home, bring him home, bring him home. He's like the son I might have known, if God had granted me a son. The summers die one by one, how soon they fly on, and I am old and will be gone. Bring him peace, bring him joy. He is young, he is only a boy. You can take, you can give, let him be, let him live. If I die, let me die, let him live. Bring him home, bring him home, bring him home.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great pleasure to be here for this very, very special event. And you all look like a very sophisticated, classy crowd. I'm not sure if you are, but you do look like that. So hands up on that note, hands up any opera fans in the audience. Five people. So because we're on somewhat of a sporting theme tonight, for those of you who don't like opera, this is one of the famous sporting anthems ever. I'd like to take you back to the World Cup in 1990. For the opera fans, it's the most famous Italian aria ever. It's Nessun Dorma from Turandot. Nessun dorma
nessun dorma. Tu purio principessa, nella tua fredda stanza, guardi le stelle che tremonau d'amore e di speranza. Ma il mio mistero chiuso in me, il nome mio nessun saprà. No, no, sulla tua bocca lo dirò quando la luce splenderà. Piaccio scioglierà silenzio che ti fa mia. All'alba vincerò, vincerò, vincerò. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. Thank you. Enjoy the rest of your evening.
What a magnificent voice Jazz Willoughby has. How amazing. Well done, Jazz. Okay, we're coming to our next panel of legends. I just want to say one thing, actually. I've had the privilege of interviewing quite a number of interesting people down the years, but I find that there's something very moving about tonight. And I see Mark and Kate Attride just sitting there in front of me. And actually, it is a testament, I said at the beginning, there's nearly 1,000 people in this room tonight. And there is a display of sporting talent that you would not get on any television show in anywhere in the world. And I think it is a tribute to how much people love you. Okay, let's see how the banter is with the managers. Right, we had the legends, the real legends, we had the young guns, and now we have the maestros, as they say. Up first, our next guest is Ireland's number one national hunt trainer and has been for the past 7 years in a row. He also holds the record for having the most winners in a season, which he took from Aidan O'Brien. This man has won every major national hunt race on both sides of the Irish Sea, including 33 races at Cheltenham. Florida Pearl, Hedge Hunter and Hurricane Fly are but a few of the legendary horses that have benefited from his expertise down the years. Give an incredibly warm welcome to Willie Mullins. Thanks for being here. Yeah. Okay, next up, what to say about this man. He's regarded as one of the best man managers in modern sport and is also, without doubt, the greatest hurling manager of all time. He has steered his native Kilkenny to a staggering 10 All-Ireland hurling titles, 6 National Leagues and 12 Leinster Championships. As a player, he himself won 3 All-Ireland senior medals and he captained Kilkenny to All-Ireland glory in 1982. He's also won an All-Star twice in his career. On top of this, he's won the most difficult medal in hurling, an All-Ireland club medal with his native James Stevens twice. Give a really warm welcome to Kilkenny hurling manager, Brian Cody. Okay, it stays just as good. Our next guest, I said Mark Attride, really, can you just book all my guests in future? There's a new. Our next guest is nothing short of a colossus in the rugby world. As Leinster head coach, he has delivered not one but 2 Heineken Cups for the province in 2011-2012. Since then, he's gone on to his current position as Ireland's head coach, where he has coached the team to win this year's Six Nations Championship. He's also the man who nearly brought down the All Blacks last November when Ireland were pipped to the post by 2 points in the Aviva. Give an incredibly warm welcome to Ireland's favourite Kiwi, Joe Schmidt. And as I say, it stays just as good. Our next guest is one of the most respected, controversial and brilliantly talented businessmen. No, but actually I would emphasise brilliantly talented businessmen that Ireland has ever seen. Over the years, he has turned the fledgling operator Ryanair into the huge colossus and success that it is today. In the sporting world, he's also won the Cheltenham Gold Cup with his horse War of Attrition. And he's here tonight because he was in school with Mark and Clongos. Give a really warm welcome to the one, the only, Micheal O Leary.
To the moon, let me play among the stars.
Let
me see what spring looks like on.
Okay, straight up, Micheal, what was Mark like in school? Let's cut to the chase here.
I should start by saying thank you for that wonderful and dishonest introduction. So, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to a panel with 3 sporting legends and that big bollocks from Ryan.
This is going to be good.
Other than the Mullingar under-9s, I have no idea what I'm doing here.
And Mark, what about Mark in Clongowes? What was he like as a schoolboy?
Mark was one of the super talented athletes in Clongowes. Now, it was Clongowes, so we didn't have too many super talented athletes. There was a lot of farmers' sons, and then there was one or two like Archie, who was good at almost everything he did. Super talented, didn't have to bother. Good at rugby, good at soccer, good at athletics, not so good at golf. But you know, you have to have one or two drawbacks. But he was a legend in Clongowes. He was on the team, obviously, that won the Clongowes first senior cup winning team since about 1822 or something like that. And Clongowes have never looked back since that team made the breakthrough in 1978, Archie and Willie Burns and a couple of other, what would be Clongowes legends, which would be a fairly small pool of tadpoles generally.
Would you give up all your success in business to be one of the 3 guys beside you?
I normally do these things where you say, we give away a pair of free flights to Madrid for the... Anybody who comes up with a new question that I haven't heard in the last 20 years. So, Miriam, you get the pair of free flights to Madrid. I have to say, honestly, no.
Okay.
It's much better at the age of 53 just being a humble business person, running a very humble airline, doing very humble things, and being invited to sit on a panel that I'm entirely unqualified to sit on with 3 sporting legends. If I could hang on to the money, I'd like to come back and be Willie, obviously, because he knows he wins far more races at Cheltenham than I do. But other than that, no, I'm very happy where I am.
Okay, Willie, when I was talking... Yeah. I know your dad, Paddy, was a huge influence, but why do you think you've had such incredible success in your career?
Well, I think when my father was training, he was very successful at what he did for the clients that he did it for. But I think we're lucky enough in this generation to train for people like Michael, people with a lot more investment put into the game. And the game has just grown up hugely. You know, I try to say to my son all the time, you know, this is not real. This most of the trainers around the country don't have the sort of investment we have into the business, and certainly trainers of another generation. I think we're just lucky. With the Celtic Tiger came along, we were lucky, we were there for it, picked it up, and we've got some huge businessmen in Ireland who want to have their horses trained in Ireland. Beforehand, they sent them to England.
Do you know when a horse is great?
If we did, I suppose it'd be easy, but no, obviously you don't. You buy, you just try and buy lots of young talent. It's like, you know, the two men sitting beside me, they get a heap of schoolboys and they see them, and sometimes, someday you see, there's Henry Shefflin, you know, David, there's a DJ Carey or something like that over there, and you say, they might be the ones. We see those every day, but sometimes they, injury-wise, they go, their head goes. So you might see 8 or 10 of them, and, you know, probably once or twice during the year, I'm hoping when I'm galloping my horse that something just pops his head up, and I say, wow, that's the one, and hopefully he just stays right for me. It's very hard. If you knew and you went out and bought them, then the rich man would have everything, but you've just got to buy a selection of them and hope that one or two turn out.
And Brian Cody, I mean, so many people, even people I've met down the years, and you talk about how people can be inspirational. And you are legendary in terms of, seriously, your dressing room and what you say and how you inspire. But where did that come from in you? Like, what were your parents like? What grew this Brian Cody who inspires people so well?
Hard to say, Miriam, I don't know. My parents, obviously, you get what you get from your parents, essentially.
Tell me about him a bit.
My father was hugely interested in hurling. He was very much involved. He was chairman of our local club there for a long time. And obviously, I would have been influenced hugely by my parents, and that's what gave me my love of hurling, I suppose, really, and got me started. And, you know, primary teacher, started off teaching in my own locality, my own parish, my own club is in that area as well. So I just got involved in it very, very early. And while I was playing, I was involved in coaching the school team and that. And I suppose it's just something you have an instinct for, really, you know. And it wasn't ever my ambition to manage the Kilkenny team or anything like that, but just the job became available at a particular time when I was sort of wondering what I do, and I felt like doing something, and I just took it on and just got on from there, really, you know. And I suppose I just approach it in a way that I find comfortable myself. I don't have any big massive philosophy on the thing. I just instinctively went with what I went with and followed my own sort of gut feeling in lots of ways and everything I do. And when you talk about, everyone talks about the manager now, but it's a management team and it's a whole group of people you're working with, and you're totally dependent on the people you are working with. And obviously, at the end of the day, when the whistle blows for the start of the game, the players decide the winning and losing of the game, and you're on the sideline and you're never massively inspired or anything, just game just goes ahead. And very, very lucky to have such a talented group of players around at the time as well, and been very fortunate the way it's gone.
And how much, though, is being tough on people, and how much is always being nice to people? Like, do you have to balance that very delicately? It's like Micheal O'Leary is known for being, I think you're quite tough on your employees, aren't you?
I'm very warm and cuddly. It's legendary how famous around the world for being, and getting warmer and even cuddlier as we speak.
That is true. But I'm interested, I come back to Michael, but like in your case, Brian, how do you go from maybe, I know, you even see it with kids, I see it. You inspire them a bit and help them, but then sometimes you have to be tough on them. And is it hard to be tough on them?
Yeah, well, a lot of people talk about, you know, ruthless managers and all that kind of stuff in the media. Your label as being this or that or the other thing. Whereas in actual fact, if you do something that you believe is right for the team, it's called ruthless. if it's not what a lot of people think they would like to see happening. You know, everybody likes to pick their own team and have the players they love playing and everything else. And you know what you firmly believe. I mean, the buck stops with you. You have to decide what happens. You pick the team that you believe is going to be the best possible chance for you to win the game. And if you're not prepared to go with what you think is right, then you're certainly not doing your job right. And if you do go with that, then you're labelled by some people as being ruthless. So it's just a ridiculous kind of a labelling of things, I think. You know, you do what you believe is right. And if you're afraid to do that, then you shouldn't be doing it, essentially. Mm-hmm. That's the way I would approach it.
Do you feel like that, Joe? I mean, same kind of job, but different sport.
Yeah, I think the crossover is very close. And, you know, chatting with Willie and Brian before we came out, just talking about trying to instill confidence and trying to instill a belief in people that they're capable of doing something and, you know, then letting them go out and deliver it, you know. And I've been fortunate that I've had some very good people and you know, obviously some of those people were, well, one of them was here tonight. I'm not sure that I'd say I'd have a lot of confidence in Shawnee.
Ruby Walsh will have a word with you.
I just thought it was brilliant the way Ruby really put it up to him tonight. It was great to see the big fella squirming. I've actually never seen him sit down so long and stay awake. So I might have to get Ruby into some of our team meetings,
yeah,
just to make sure Shawnee works his way right through them. But no, it is very much about trying to keep that confidence and do what's right. If you do believe and you've got your staff, as Brian said, the staff are massively important, and I'd be really lucky. I've got a world-class staff that work with me, and there's a misconception that I've made an impact where I know that Jason Cowman's done a great job with our S&C. I just had two discussions while I've been here with Dr. Anna Falvey about players, and he's already trying to manage as best he can a couple of guys leading into the autumn series. So, you know, good people allow me to have a position that I wouldn't necessarily be worthy of, but it's quite nice being there if you are winning.
Yeah, you're clearly way worthy, so worthy. But Micheal, what you have run probably one of the most successful businesses in Ireland. I mean, you built it when people couldn't afford to fly to London even. You created an airline which enabled a whole generation of people, that's true, to come home more regularly, and that's very important to people. Where did you get your entrepreneurial and managerial ability? Tell me about your background. Tell me about your parents, actually.
Firstly, you're in danger of rewriting history. I mean, I didn't found Ryanair. If I had, God help us, it'd be called O'Leary Air. See? In which case, it would be even meaner and nastier to the customer base than Ryanair is. I mean, Tony Ryan was the founding genius in Ryanair. Mm-hmm. Made a fortune in aircraft leasing. Like, all I did was come along behind and was given a kind of a...
No, you turned it round. History says you turned it round.
Yeah, but history's always written by the winner, so don't spend too much time worrying about history. Look, you know, we have an enormous opportunity here in Ireland. And unlike these gentlemen who are, you know, legends in their own sports, you know, I'm not even a legend in the Mullingar under-9 coaching setup. We get to go and compete, though, with other airlines across Ireland originally, across Europe, across the world. And it's fun, we're bigger than all of them now, and we want to double it in size in the next 5 or 10 years. But we shouldn't spend too much time on Ryanair this evening when we have an opportunity to hear from three true sporting legends. And the little bollocks in Ryanair.
But I suppose key to this panel is people who've managed to manage people, and I suppose inspire and build either successful teams or brilliant stables or successful companies. What is, for young Jack, God help him, he's 8, he's still listening to you, Micheal, in the front row. He could be one of your under-9s. What do you think is the most important thing about trying to run a successful business, team, company. No, don't dismiss it, because it's boring for Jack.
Yeah, but business is different to sporting engagement. Like,
well, is it?
Because the guys can, I mean, Brian can only deal with what, you know, he has, what he has in Kilkenny. Willie can only work with the horses that he can source or buy. It's very hard to get good horses. The same with Joe. You know, you're limited to people with Irish passports. In business, you can actually chop and change. You can bring in outside resources, all the rest of it. But I think what drives, certainly me, is ambition. You know, I wanted to be, you know, I took over Ryanair when it was tiny, 200,000 passengers. Aer Lingus were carrying about 4 million passengers. I wanted to be bigger than Aer Lingus. We got to be bigger than Aer Lingus, then I wanted to be, who's next? British Airways, right? They had 28 million passengers. I wanted to be bigger than them. We got to that, who's next? Lufthansa, 60 million passengers. Okay, we're now at 90 million passengers. Who's next? Southwest Airlines in the States have 120 million passengers, so I've now ordered enough planes to go to 150 million passengers. Own quiet business way, I think what you're always looking for is where's the next mountaintop, what's the next challenge, how do you win more, how do you get bigger, get better, get faster. And I think the people who, you know, certainly looking from the outside as a one of life's great sporting failures, these three gentlemen, I think, have the same talent and ambition. They're never satisfied with winning the last game, they're always moving on to the next game.
That's probably not that much different, really, is it, than what, in a sense, if you want to achieve even a newer business, what Mike was saying, he saw different goals that he wanted to achieve. So it's not, is it dissimilar, would you say?
Yeah, I mean, we're always looking to the next one. You know, once Cheltenham's over, you're looking to Punchestown or next year's Cheltenham. And that's, I think that's the way you have to be. If you're ambitious, you've got to, what happened last week is history. Go forward, look for the next year's team. And we don't come away with the same level of financial reward as your man over on the ice. We get it in other ways, I suppose, but yeah.
You've had so many wins. I was asking Micheal and Jimmy that earlier. Is there a particular win, a particular horse? What for you is one of your happiest memories of your career today?
Well, I suppose on the training level, winning the Grand National with the Hedge Hunter, you know, from the time you're that height, you want to win the National. And that was just, everything just came right on the day. It was absolutely extraordinary. As a person, I suppose, my son winning in, riding a winner in Cheltenham was...
Patrick.
Yeah. And then he rode the 4 mile chase winner last year, you know, and I think those two things, as a man or as a father, that, and as a racehorse trainer, a professional winning the Grand National.
But like the morning that you won that Grand National, do you have kind of a ritual? Do you wake up and think, this is the day of the Grand National? Do you say a prayer?
I'll tell you what it was like.
Yeah.
So anyhow, my wife is reading the paper, whatever it was, January time, Nationals, whenever it is. And she says, we won at the National. I says, oh, it was the first week in April. Everyone knows that. So she says, great, there's a brand new hotel opening in Liverpool. We'll book that and you can have it for half price or something, whatever. We arrive over to Liverpool, it's the second week in April. No hotel, place booked out. So we end up in some place down on the docks at about 25 quid a night, but at least we had a bed. I had Patrick, a couple of his schoolmates, sleeping on the floor. So this was team preparation. But anyhow, the horse went out and won the National. Lo and behold, the celebration party was next door, so we were in the race.
Yeah.
But wait till I tell you another one. So we're coming down to the party, the celebration party, after going back up. The management of the hotel had champagne at first. That was lovely. So down to the hotel, or this club next door, and there we are, milling around the door. Your name, please, Willie Mullins. You're not on the list. So I had to actually ring Ruby to get me in. That was my grand answer.
And on that, when the race actually starts, do you look or do you look away?
Oh, like, I always look at everything. I always bring my binoculars. I mean, the entry, I don't know whether people are in there or not, but it's an unusual track. It just gallops away from you for a mile or a mile and a half, and back for a mile and a half. It's so hard to see. You're better off watching television if the camera doesn't jump around too much. But I prefer to get up on the stand, and watch it live, you know, because I think you'll only watch it live once. You can watch it on camera or TV another time, but the camera does lie, I think. And, you know, I like to watch it live from one position so I know where everything is. And but it's so hard, the crowds are so huge over there. But anyway, that's what I do.
And Brian, for your sake, when you won this year, how sweet a victory is that? Is every victory as sweet? Or for you, the way I asked Willie, is there a certain win that stands out for you, or is that just a boring question?
No, I suppose really, I mean, every year you start off and there's a few competitions, obviously, there's the league and there's the provincial championship and there's the, obviously, the All-Ireland final. That's the one you want to win. You know, you'd like to win the rest as well, but the pinnacle is the All-Ireland final.
The Liam McCarthy.
The Liam McCarthy, every year, yeah, that's the one you want. And I've been very fortunate, obviously, to win what we've won. And, you know, the one that's on, I mean, we just won it a few weeks ago, but, you know, like the lads were saying earlier as well, we've won it and that's it, like, you know, and it was brilliant on the day and we've won the previous ones and they're brilliant on the day as well, but it's gone and it's just something we did. And obviously the ambition is for players and everybody else that life goes ahead and you see what's next, you know, but there's not a question, there's not one that stands out in my head really as being one that was better than the others. This one obviously because the most recent, you know, but that's the way it is. And I think if you want to kind of stay competitive, you've got to be thinking ahead more so, really, and looking back and kind of enjoying too much about it. It is hugely enjoyable, but the enjoyment is there at the time. It's there for a few minutes afterwards, and on the pitch and in the dressing room afterwards, and then life goes ahead after that, really.
Do you have a ritual on the day, say, of the All-Ireland Day? Like, do you have a fry in the morning? Do you say a prayer? No, I'm just wondering.
Yeah, no, no. Like you see, with us, we just drive up on the day of the game. We go up by bus for the day of the game. Some counties would go up overnight. You know, counties would be far away and that. No, I just carry on as normal. I don't ever have to fry for breakfast, so I would just have my normal breakfast. And we get together and we go up by bus and we go to a team hotel and we'd have some food there. And we wouldn't have a meeting there or anything like that. The lads just kind of just spend a bit of time there. Just get to hurl the ball out and tip around for a while. And we head to Croke Park. And one of the most enjoyable parts for the lads, I think, is the Garda escort into Croke Park, where the crowds are gathering and it's around there, and it's a bit of excitement around that. And we get to the dressing room, and I suppose we're fortunate, we've done it a good few times and that, you know. And
yeah.
I don't mean that in any kind of conceited way. The excitement is as ever, you know. But it's, you know, it's something we're used to doing, if you like, and we're very fortunate to have that. And we kind of, I suppose, are comfortable enough doing the way we do it.
And for you, Joe, are you like him? In other words, you're only as good as your last win, and you don't look back; you look forward.
Yeah, I'd be the same as both William and Brian. I think one of the things, we won a thing called the Ranfurly Shield with Bay of Plenty when I just sort of started coaching and fell into coaching, and I'd played for it, and we'd never won it, and it was the first time, I think, 105 years that Bay of Plenty had been trying to win it and they never won it. And when they won it, apparently it was a really good night when it was described to me afterwards. I think you do need to celebrate those because you work so hard for them that you almost do need a bit of a valve afterwards. I think, the Six Nations, it's funny, I didn't really feel fantastic after the Six Nations. You're still wondering how Pascal Pape managed to throw the ball forward, not backward. And so we're a little bit lucky. And, it's the next morning for me that was really special, because then you wake up, you've had a good, at least an hour and a half, 2 hours sleep. You've spent the previous night trying to hydrate with... with sparkling water, and you wake up and there was 134 texts on my phone, a number of missed calls, and the sun was shining in the window, and you're in the middle of Paris, and you get up. I sat up and I replied to some of the texts until people started replying back to me again. I can't talk to these people, and gave it up. But the one thing that does force you to think ahead is, I'll never forget coming into the airport afterwards, you know, because I'd rehydrated fully the night before, I was a little bit unsteady, and because Paul O'Connell is about three times my size, we had the trophy, so it's a bit lopsided, you know. But I came in, and a guy just to my left, he goes, fantastic, Joe, what a great Six Nations, well done. And I'm just thinking, it's pretty well done, let's just keep a straight line here. And then he said, now for the World Cup. And so if I wasn't thinking in the future, he certainly was already. And I think that sometimes you'd like time to stand still for just a while so you can enjoy it a little bit longer, but time doesn't stand still, and so you're pretty quickly looking ahead and trying to get further forward than the other teams. I think the other teams are getting better all the time, so you know, if we replicate what we did in the Six Nations this year, for next season, you know, we might get second or third at best, because other teams are going to be better again. So we have to try to challenge ourselves to be better. It's a bit like, you know, we can't, as Michael said, buy more aeroplanes, but we can develop more players and get a better base, hopefully, and go forward. You know, he's talking about a lot of people. We don't have that many people, but hopefully the select group that we do have can demonstrate that they've gone forward as well.
And interesting, Michael, despite your enormous success, which everybody, by the way, in this country recognises, you love sport. And I think you genuinely, when you say you're sitting beside these three guys, really mean that they are exceptional in their fields. So do you love the fact now that you are part of horse racing, that your horse has achieved so much, and that your brother, I know, is very involved? Is that a side of life now that you love and means a lot to you? Be sentimental.
I can't be sentimental because, you know, my involvement in horse racing is as an owner. So if there's a lower form of life in horse racing than the owner, I haven't yet met him.
You're way too much.
You know, I tend to call Willie around the end of January, Mr. Mullins, should I book any flights to Cheltenham this year or not? And Willie doesn't tell me until about the start of March. I love horse racing. I grew up in the country. I grew up around on a farm. You know, I'm privileged to have enough money to be able to buy a few horses. And what I like about certainly the jumps racing in Ireland is the talent we have in this country is phenomenal. Like, it's not just Willie, it's not just Ruby. There is an incredible array of extraordinarily talented trainers, extraordinarily talented jockeys, extraordinarily talented stable staff here. And I happen to kind of float in on race day. And if you have a winner, I love having winners. I hate having seconds. Not interested in, you know, and you have to kind of grin and show up and do your well done to whoever won the feckin' race. Pretend really that you're a good sport and all the rest of it, whereas actually I hate it. I'd rather go to Castletown Gagan for a point to point if I was going to have a winner there than go up and be second in Cheltenham or third in Nace or wherever else it is. So, but I think that's what, you know, ultimately, you know, what makes these great sporting legends is that they're winners and they will do whatever it takes to be winners. I mean, I've seen Willie's setup, it's extraordinary down there. I mean, you know, with the greatest respect, you know, and I come from Mullingar, so I think I can say, you know, the arse end of Carlo Kilkenny border. You look at the kind of way the professionals said, the professional people, what they're turning out, what he doing, he's rewriting the records in jump racing. In this country, he's rewriting the records in the UK. And as a small owner in the firmament, you're very privileged to be along for the ride with, you know, what is somebody who's rewriting all the jump racing records in this country.
But did you get more of a thrill when your horse won than maybe some of the biggest success days of Ryanair's balance sheet?
Oh, yeah. I mean, you know, the Ryanair days are fun and it's a challenge and all the rest, and I enjoy doing it. But, you know, the winning the Gold Cup in Cheltenham will be a day I will never forget in my life. I made the fatal mistake in some interview a couple of years ago, what was the most momentous day of your life? And of course, I plunged straight into winning the Gold Cup in War of Attrition. My wife saw it. after four children, and said, what about the wedding? Oh, fuck, that was a bloody nightmare. What about the children? Yeah, that was okay, it wasn't, but nothing compares to winning a Gold Cup in Cheltenham. The sad thing was, I had the great good fortune to win the Gold Cup with the fourth horse I ever bought. And if I'd stopped then, I would probably be worth about twice as much as I am today, because you throw huge amounts of money at it trying to get back there. And the reality is, for most people, Willie is different, but for most people, if you win one Gold Cup in your life, that's your ration. If you could win a champion hurdle, that'll be your ration. Sure, I should have stopped in 2006 when he'd won, but I can't help myself.
Which are easier to train, horses or owners?
Oh, the owners are very easy to train, but really.
When Michael won the Gold Cup, I thought it was fantastic. He obviously set out to be top owner, and he got his brother to go and source the horses. And here they were within a year, was it your first or second season, you won the Gold Cup?
Oh, no, it's about the third season.
Yeah. Well, I just thought,
but it was easy, you know.
Absolutely.
Is there a horse in history, Willie? I mean, you've had so much success, but is there a horse in history that wasn't yours, whether it's like 100 years ago or whatever, that you'd love to have trained?
I don't know how to answer that. I mean, you'd love to have trained Arkle, but would you do as good a job? I look at one of the best horses I ever had, Florida Pearl, and I wonder, would I do a lot better job nowadays with the experience I have? I thought at the time I did everything right, and then as the years go by, you think, ooh, should I have done something else? And so it's very hard. No, I don't look at other people's horses and wish that I had them. No, I don't. I wonder, can I do better with the ones I have?
Are you hard on yourself?
I don't know. I suppose I live for it and love it. So I'm not hard on myself. I don't consider it work. I'm lucky to have the clients I have. I'm lucky to have the horse I have and the people working for me. I mean, last year one day, I think we had about 20 or 30 days rain. Jesus, do you remember we had a dry autumn and then it just started to rain? And I went up to the gallop on Monday morning and it was just teeming out of the heavens. And all my staff were there waiting for me on the gallop. They were in their wet gear. But not one of them hung back in the yard and said it's too wet to go out. I just thought, what a team have I got. It was just, to me, whatever about the horses I had, but the guys I had riding, I thought it was one of the best moments I had last year on the gallops. And, you know, I told them that. I said, people think we have success because of the horses we have or the owners we have. And I said, no, it's down to you guys. It blew me away then on a Monday morning, whatever, but a Tuesday or Wednesday morning. Monday morning, I thought it was hugely acceptable. It was just one of the dirtiest mornings, I'd say, in my living memory.
Oh, that's so sweet. But, Brian, you've always worked full time in the past as principal of De La Salle, because we heard earlier you were teaching him. Is it difficult to combine both? I mean, you both manage this team that wins everything, and you're the principal of this big school.
Yeah, it's just, obviously we're an amateur sport, you know, and it's always been like that. You know, I played a game and I worked at a time or went to school or college or whatever it was. Everybody else involved in the game is doing the same thing. They're going to work and we train after work and we do whatever we do in sport after work. So it's just our lives really, you know. So that's the way it is, so it's not difficult. Obviously, I suppose, the particular job I'm in, we have reasonable holidays, I suppose. although Joe decided...
Michael will back that up.
Joe decided to chuck it in because the holidays weren't reasonable enough, obviously. But and we finish at a reasonable time officially, even though it goes on much longer than people imagine it goes on for as well. But so, I mean, it lends itself to doing something else, you know, obviously, in that. And so it's just normal for us. You obviously have to have an understanding wife and everything else to be able to put the time into it and that, and I'm fortunate there. So it's just, it seems pretty normal thing to do.
Do you think there's a common denominator? I mean, Michael included, of the people on the panel, of successful managers. Is there a common denominator for your success? Like, is there a trait you all have?
You're asking me, Miriam, is it? Yeah, okay. No. Listening to the three lads here speaking, I mean, ambition obviously seems to be very much a common denominator, and that would stand to reason if you weren't ambitious to continue to want more success. I mean, if you go ahead and you're doing whatever we're doing, and you win something once, and you're kind of satisfied with that, well, then you should just slip off and carry on and let somebody else do the job. But I mean, sport goes on all the time. It happens every year. And if you just don't stop because this is it, you know. It's repetition. Obviously, in Michael's situation, he's chasing something different all the time. Like he explained, he wants to take over from the next crowd, the next crowd, the next crowd. And ourselves, we go after the same competition every year. It's up for grabs every year. And that's our motivation. That's our drive the whole time. But certainly the ambition to keep doing that. But obviously, it's linked as well with enjoyment. And you enjoy doing what you're doing. Because if you don't enjoy doing it, you will not be able to do it as well as you possibly could. So it's linked in all of those things, enjoyment, ambition. And obviously as well, it kind of makes life more interesting. You know, you could, there's a ring road in Kilkenny, you could walk it forever, you know, but there's a bit of a buzz and there's a bit of excitement about it. And it does help. It does help.
Ireland, New Zealand. Actually, Paul Brennan, who organised tonight, he's really keen. I ask you about this. What was that like, Ireland versus New Zealand? Was it incredibly painful before, during and after, Joe?
Yeah, before was a little bit painful because we'd lost the Australians. And, you know, anyone who doesn't know Kiwis very well knows how they feel about Australians. So that was bad enough. But then the week went really well. And the one thing that people talk about loyalty. It's not hard to be loyal to a group of men who roll their sleeves up and prepare as well as they possibly can to try to knock over a team that they haven't knocked over in the history of the game, and a team that are on an unbeaten year if they get over the hurdle of beating us in the Aviva. And during the game, I really thought it was possible. I've got to say, and I know the players believed it was possible as well. At 19-0 and at 22-7 at half time.
He remembers it all the time.
Yeah. Do you want me to take you right through it?
Yeah.
God.
Johnny's penalty.
I'll skip that, but I did think we had it a few times, but I think the lead up to the penalty that we didn't get, I thought we played superbly. People said, "Oh, we weren't as good in the second half." We were in our own half. We worked our way up the pitch. It was a great little kick in behind from Connor Murray. Great pressure to put Bodine Barrett straight at the touch. I vaguely remember this, but we had the line out. We drove the line out. It's funny, Connor Murray's trying to pull the ball out, and Paul O'Connell's keeping it in there to keep going, and he's the boss, so that just happened. But we've got four guys on the short side. They've got two. I think if we pull it out, we maybe score. But we think we've got it anyway because we get the penalty to kick the goal. And, that, you know, sometimes those things happen. And the one thing that I would say is there are always variables you don't control. Just like in life, that's one of the reasons that we're here tonight. There are variables that are outside our control that if we let them get us down and drag us backwards, then I think that's the direction we go in. If we use those variables as a springboard and try to use that to get somewhere and go forward or take the positives that we can out of it. And one of the positives that we took out of it was that we felt that 15-on-15, we might have beaten the All Blacks last November. But the guys they brought off the bench were exceptional. And it's no disrespect to our guys off the bench, but we probably hadn't prepared them as well as we had the starting 15. We spent a lot of time on them during the week, and it's one of the lessons that, you know, Willie's talking about. You know, if he trained a horse now as opposed to 10 years ago, what would he have done better? I'm sure there are things that all four of us know that we didn't get right. Probably yesterday, that we're going to do better tomorrow, let alone going back 10 years. So for us, watching that last phase unfold where Bodine Barrett makes a line break, his replacement replacement fullback, Liam Messam, who bench presses over 200 kilos, he breaks about three tackles down the far side. Ball comes to the middle of the field, it bounces it's not even a great pass, but they pick it up, they hit in the midfield, it comes to Aaron Cruden. Aaron Cruden gives it to Dane Coles. Dane Coles, replacement hooker, stands in the tackle, offloads to Ryan Crotty, replacement centre. He, I'm sure, illegally runs over the line, puts a ball down. And then they get a second shot at the conversion. Yeah, that was, if you want to get a bit of salt and throw it in, that was probably the icing on the cake. But for me, I suppose there were never mixed loyalties. I still watch New Zealand play sport. I still watch them when they're competing because, you know, I think it's the same thing that when we went to Argentina, we went to the hurling club. Hurling club in Argentina. You can imagine, obviously Brian would know a bit about them, probably taking his team down there a few times for a game, but they are this diaspora of immigrant Irish people who are incredibly proud of their Irishness. And so, you know, I am a Kiwi, but I'm massively loyal to the guys who put that work in, and that will remain the case because they are working really hard. There's a few of them that you might see are broken, like Shawnee, who will be back hopefully for the World Cup, and we'll give that a go in time. But through the autumn, you'll see some fresh faces, and just give them your support because they'll be new on the scene and they'll be working as hard as they can to try to give the result that you want and the performance that they need to continue to take us forward.
And actually, on that point, Jimmy McGee, who's over there, was saying earlier how hard it is, I suppose, for guys when they're on the television, they're playing, and then the guys criticise them, and I suppose their mother, their father, their sister, their brothers are all listening. Do you find that, A, difficult, and B, annoying, both Brian and Joe, when your players are criticised? Or do you just get used to it? And is it damaging to the player?
Yeah, I think it can be, because players, I don't know about the Kilkenny boys, but the players inevitably are not immune to criticism because their mate down the road will mention it to them. Anyone who says they don't read the papers, it filters back to them. And I think some of it sometimes can be harsh and personal. Mm. I think anyone can have a poor performance, you know. You might not quite get the right playing, but, you know, that's probably not publicised and reported on. I don't know, maybe.
No, it is. When they get on the wrong plane, it's always publicised and reported on. It's my fault.
Yeah, and justifiably so in your context, but in ours, I think it's...
Bloody Kiwis.
look, we both share that same love of Mullingar, Michael, so I think, it is tough on them when it's personal criticism. When, you know, some of those guys, what they've done to prepare and get onto the pitch is incredible. And I do think that sometimes it is frustrating for them. And I know that there are some people that none of them would ever engage in a conversation with because of the track record of what has been said about them. And there are some people that I wouldn't choose to talk to because I know that the players, they wouldn't approve of me talking to that particular person because of what is blunt personal criticism.
Yeah.
You've got to get a little bit immune to it, but I don't think anyone is completely immune to it, and certainly not families, because, you know, I've got young kids. I remember, my son getting a hard time when we lost a couple of games in Auckland because his dad was shite, you know. And I'd be the first to admit I wasn't that good, but I didn't want people to know that publicly, and it certainly wasn't great for my son, you know, to get that feedback, because he thought I was great.
Yeah.
He knows better now, he's 18. No, unfortunately, they grow up.
But Michael, as we draw to a close, in terms of, I suppose, either rugby wins or hurling or fantastic wins by Willie, what do you think sport means for us as a nation? How important is sport to us and the kind of genuine sporting legends you have to your right tonight?
I think, you know, sport is very important to Ireland because we're a very small nation. And as a very small nation, you know, we there are not that many things that we excel at. We do produce some, you know, spectacular sports people. I would personally regret the fact that actually it's so disparate in this country. It'd be much better if we all concentrated in, you know, the rugby or the GAA. But it's not that way. And yet for a population of 4 million people, when we produce a Rory McIlroy or you produce a Henry Shefflin who wins, I mean, I can't even imagine what 10 All-Irelands are. In the jumping, you know, we're kind of more used in the jumping to producing world superstars. I think we live in the basket of the reflected glory of it because we're a small nation and because it's one of the areas where we can excel. I think what we have to do, though, as a nation is take those examples and you look at the people who excel, the Henry Shefflins, the Willie Mullins, the Joe Smiths, the Brian Codys. It comes from incredible drive, incredible ambition, but extraordinary hard work. And everyone, you know, a lot of us would do an awful lot better if we just worked that bit harder and were a bit more dedicated, because that's certainly what sport teaches you, is nothing succeeds like success. Gary Player said, the harder I practice, the luckier I get. And nobody, whether it's the Dublin GAA team or the Leinster team, the Munster team, Willie, in every field in sport, the people who succeed are not the most talented. The people who succeed are always the ones who train harder, try harder, keep trying, and when they're succeeding, try harder and harder again. And I think, you know, certainly from a business perspective, that's what succeeds. The harder you work, the better you get.
So to wrap up, I'm going to ask you all four, and sticking with you, for those lovely Jack and his friend beside him there, best piece of advice then for life? Is it work hard? What is the best piece of advice you would give the young boy sitting in the front row?
Work hard in school, work hard at sport. Whatever it is you like doing, whatever is your dream, follow it, but never lose sight of the dream. Never give up. Keep chasing it. Keep chasing it. If you really work hard at it and dedicate yourself to it, it will come true.
Joe?
Enjoy it. I enjoy working hard because I'm massively competitive. And if we had a game of tiddlywinks here, I'd be practicing to try to get an edge on Michael or Brian or Willie. So enjoy it. Enjoy being competitive. I think sometimes people get told it's not important to win. It's just important to partake. It's important to partake and give it everything. You can't control whether you win or not, but just enjoy competing at what you want to succeed at.
Brian?
I think all of us, everybody has a talent, a particular talent that they, it goes with something they enjoy doing, they're happy doing, they get something from it, they get a buzz from it, or whatever it is. I think they should really, you know, bring that as far as they possibly can bring it, you know, have the ambition to go wherever it brings you, you know, no matter how far the challenge brings you, just keep with it. And I would say the importance of let nobody knock you along the way. They will knock you and they'll try to knock you, but have a self-belief and a confidence in yourself. And there will always be somebody, family or a coach or whatever, will help you along the way to kind of realise that the potential is within you to do that. And some people will get there quickly and some people will take longer to get there. But to keep going and get there and enjoy the journey and just let nothing stop you, really.
Willie?
Yeah, I think I'm going to echo everything they said. I mean, when I was, I had one job in my life. I worked for Jim Bulger. He paid me very well. I thought I would shovel shit all day for Jim if I got enough money. And I actually found that, okay, I had all this money in my pocket and he treated me, now I worked all day for him. You know what I said to him? I'm not enjoying this. And so I went home to do what I enjoyed. And I got far more pleasure working for nothing for my father, as we all did. And then I knew what I wanted to do. I wanted to just train horses. And because I just realised what it was. I wanted to do what I wanted to do, and money didn't come into it. It was ambition, I suppose, and I just enjoyed. And as I said to you here earlier on, I don't consider it work. I consider it a play. It's what I enjoy doing, and you have to enjoy doing what you're going to do.
Well, thank you.
You are four of the most successful men in Ireland today. You've made such a difference. You came here tonight. You gave up of your time. It's been a privilege for us to listen to you. And it's a tribute to Mark, how much everyone means to you, Mark, that they are here. So thanks so much for being here tonight. Inviting up Paul Brennan, who organised this entire do tonight, and his Jack in the front row, Daddy. So give a warm welcome to Paul Brennan.
Thanks very much, Miriam. First of all, I want to say, what a show. Absolutely. And just that to be noted that all of the guests that we had tonight, so we started this back in last July, okay, when Mark came to the clubs. All of the guests that we asked, okay, we had a sort of a wish list of guests, a wish list of 10 guests, and Miriam being our number one presenter. We asked Miriam on a Friday, on a Saturday Miriam had said yes. All of the guests then we asked, not one of them said no. There's no fall, no fee, you know, no one's making anything out of this, no one's getting expenses, no one's getting anything like that. So I think it's a credit, you know, just because when you hear of these people, you know, and they're on huge books and all of this, you know. You know, but they can come. But they're on huge books, you know what I mean? But they come down, you know, because at the end of the day, Mark is a sporting guy. He's a club guy. You know, as long as I've known him, he's been a volunteer in clubs. He's helped out in the local rugby club. He's helped out in the local GA club. He's helped out, he set up park tennis in the tennis club. He's been a lecturer in Carlow IT. He's probably, to be honest with you, everyone aspires to be a family man. You know, if I was to be aspire to be someone, it would be Mark. You know, I mean, despite your illness, you still brought the greater good and you decided to put this fundraiser together. It's been inspirational working with you over the past few months. And on behalf of all of us, I genuinely wish for the wind to be at your back going forward. You're a great man, and I hope that you remember this night and this moment in time if ever things get you down in the future. We are all behind you. Ladies and gentlemen, please show your support and give a huge round of applause for the man of the moment, Mark Attride. And basically, that says it all about Mark. I would like to thank Miriam. And sorry, lads, I haven't one for you, but I have a lovely bouquet of flowers for Miriam.
Thanks so much, Paul.
Because you often hear about, like, we don't often meet these big stars from the telly. But I have to say, she's been absolutely lovely. Lovely. And anyone that's met him, or anyone that's met her, knows that lovely. And even Mario said you were lovely. So, after been a brilliant night, thank you very much for your support for Mark. Don't forget, good man Sheila downstairs. Thank you, good night, and God bless.